All right, I've got everything set up on my end. We are in Twitch and get the green light. We'll count it down for last word number 64. All right, going 3, 2.
All right, and we are live. The last word with Ebontis, and who's the special guest we got?
Oh, man. We do. Very excited to have our special guest here today. But I'm not the one who handles the intros. That one I will pass back to you, sir. It is the last word. We got a lot of Destiny to talk about today. As always, thank you guys for jumping into chat. But the man of the introductions is here. So I'm going to go ahead and put my mic to the side and let him handle his business. It's what he's known for. Let's get to it.
Let's get to it, man. Welcome to the last word, episode number 64. It's another glorious Friday, and we're back in front of the comp campfire for some looter shooter discussion. I'm extremely excited about our special guest, so we're going to get right into it. I want to introduce a Lord whose positive mindset and passion for the Destiny franchise is truly a sight to behold. Whether it be his extreme detailed weapon and armor reviews or his willingness to help others in the community, this Lord, in my opinion, represents the epitome of cool. Introducing the creator and host of the Cool Guy YouTube and Twitch channels, the Lord of getting you in the proper mindset to succeed, and one of the very few guardians to keep the Crucible flag raised high with his love of PvP. Live from Missouri, and kind enough to make his debut within the realm of the last word, my man, Lord Cool Guy. How you doing, sir?
I'm good. Good morning, guys. How are you?
Morning,
doing
man.
Great, doing great. Glad to have you in here, man.
Absolute
glad
pleasure
to be here, you, man.
Well, it is going to be a fun morning this morning, so we've got quite a bit to talk about. But just to get going, tell everybody, I'm sure a lot of people already know, but if they don't, let them know kind of what you do, what your content's all about, kind of what got you into the world of Destiny, and we'll just start with you, man.
So my channel's mostly around, I first started it way back when, and I started making videos with my Xbox, right? I didn't have a capture card, I didn't have anything like that, and I just wanted to say like 5 things on YouTube because I felt like I could help players just be a little bit better at the game, enjoy the game a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Doing that, and people liked what I had to say. And ultimately, I just kept going and going. Planet Destiny, way back when they had like 400,000 subscribers, yep, noticed me and they said, hey, you know, we like you to make some content. So I was like, well, you know, a cheat capture card and a computer that, like, it literally took 7 hours to render a video. Like,
oh my God. I know the feeling.
It was so bad.
But oh man.
Like at night, I would try to render this video and hopefully wake up and please just don't let it crash. Right. Like that was where I was. But, you know, I had a passion for it. And, you know, now, of course, I have the dual monitor and Elgato and all that.
Woo!
Nice.
You know, I do weapon reviews and I do armor reviews, but it all started on that basis of like Crucible tips. And I'm now starting to get back into that on my channel. I love it to death.
Nice. Nice.
In a Destiny, man, it's Bungie, dude. Like, through and through, Xbox guy, right? I play on Xbox.
Oh, you know, my man.
They made 2 and 3, they made Reach, and then stopped, right? And they gave the rights over to Microsoft and 343. I didn't really like Halo 4, unfortunately. And I'm a huge Halo fan, but we kind of found out they're working on this game called Destiny. So. Mm. I feel personally that no one makes a first-person shooter like Bungie, man. Like,
no, say it with your chest. Continue.
The movement, and you know, I mean, we got space magic. Like, it's a phenomenal experience, dude. So, what better time to start making YouTube than, you know, a franchise and a world I like to be a part of, right? So,
absolutely, absolutely. Good stuff, man. A lot of good history. And yeah, man, one thing I really appreciate about you, and I know we spoke off air, was just that, like, your attention to detail, but also, like, mindset. Like, you kind of, when you do your reviews, it's really cool because it's like, sometimes it's things that I personally think are useless. I'm like, I got Controverse Hold, whatever. And then I watch your video on Controverse Hold, and I'm seeing how effective you are with it, and just mindset and spacing. And I'm like, all right, I got to use it because Cool Guy said it's cool. It's be effective. But yeah, you're really good at that, man. Really good.
First hold rocks, dude.
Woo!
I don't know why everybody was saying that thing sucks or it was bad. Thing's awesome.
Absolutely.
Oh, even just your recent video, the one on just the PvP, the improve your KD guide, your third one that you had recently in the last couple days, I think. Just your movement and spacing, and one of it's either the intro section or later on when you're talking about it. I'll watch you go through this like hunter, dodge, jump, pop your golden gun, hit two people in the face, turn to the other side, and I'm going, damn. So it's like, I was just like, I want to be like cool guy. Like, I want to be like Mike over there. So no, just watching the movement and stuff like that. And I honestly, I started as a hunter in D1. And then when King's Fall came out, or King's Fall, yeah, Taken King came out, I honestly went to my Titan. I've been more Titan. But then I watched the mobility on that hunter, and I'm like, there's a reason. There's a reason they kick my butt in PvP. And just watching you do that, I'm like, damn. So no, it's impressive to watch a skilled player, and you do it in a very calm, collected way. You're detailed, as he's saying, like the detail that you put into each piece. You don't miss any aspect of whatever you're reviewing. Is it this? Is it PvP? Is it PvE? Is it good here? Should you probably be doing this? Like all these little things you take into account that will show off. Basically, I almost feel like you are like, okay, who made this weapon or piece of armor at Bungie? How can I show it off the best? Because you're going to give it as much love as like whoever made, who created the thing in the first place probably wanted it to get. And they're sitting over there like, thank you, cool guy. Appreciate you giving some love to my piece of armor because somebody's not liking it. So, no.
I appreciate it, man.
Yeah, it's great to watch. And your climb has been awesome to watch. And can't wait to see you crack over 100,000 in no time. I'm sure you'll be there. So
almost there, man. We're almost there. Could be next year. Could be next month. I don't care. And we're just going We're just gonna go along with it, dude. But like when I play, like if you look at my top five weapons overall, like it's just so scattered.
Well, sure
I have probably like 150,000 Crucible kills. Like I play a lot of Crucible, but I don't really like Luna's Howl or Not Forgotten. They're pushed way down. It's kind of weird things. Like Flash and Thunder's in my top five.
Okay.
Single shot grenade launcher. Yeah. Like it's just oddball things. That when I make content, right? So especially with like the double primary meta. You guys remember that?
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
Huckleberry, let me tell you, on console, that's tough right there. Okay. Yeah. Using Huckleberry against like Uriel's Gift on that back then. But I'll use it for like 5, 10 days and just try to make a video on it and tuffers trying to, you know, get good content out of it. But I use a wide variety because every single one, even the blue guns, every single gun in Destiny, I have shot, right? Like, I just, and how they work, it doesn't matter if it's blue or a legendary or an exotic, dude. I love it to death.
Yeah, man. That's what I like about you because I'm not talented you with all these variety of weapons, but the thing that's cool is that, like, I'm a person that likes to go against the grain. So if the meta is something like back in the day with the Euro's Gift and all that stuff, and then obviously we had a Luna's Howl stuff, I'm the person trying to find effective counters or other weapons as well in that type of meta. Because I just don't like doing what everyone else is doing, you know what I mean, kind of thing. And that's, again, another reason why I appreciate your video, because you do show that practicality.
On that, man. And one of my favorite loadouts, I mean, on console, it's probably different on PC. I love like a Monarch Duke combo. Mm-hmm. It's so deadly on console, man. Like, I read it in comp, dude. Like, I'll run. Dropped a game. I'm at about 3,000 comp score. Haven't lost, and I've been running Kepri, Sting, Monarch, and Duke. Like, it can be done, I'm telling you. Like, so.
Oh, yeah. What's that Duke roll, real quick? What's that roll on that Duke? What's that roll?
Rapid hit Rampage.
Nice. Rapid hit's beautiful on Duke. Oh, man.
Okay, I have like five of those. Can you tell me which one I should keep?
Yeah, so you can stop hoarding.
I have a vault problem, so that's a whole different issue.
Rapid hit kill clip, rapid hit rampage, and like there's rapid hit opening shot, right? The cool thing about the high impacts and rampage is once you get the kill, it starts doing 100 to the head, so you can start two tapping people. So all you have to do with Monarch, because I run poison damage, no matter what, once you get a headshot, you're just going to get a one headshot cleanup kill. The next guy's a two tap. So there's a rampage mod on there. So you have 5 seconds to search for the second guy to run it. So it's cool with Monarch because the poison damage, because if you hit him in the head, you can hit him with the body of the Duke. If you hit the Monarch in the body, you have to hit the head with the Duke. So on and so forth.
So you're just two tapping all day long, basically. That sounds quite pretty effective.
Yeah, Duke hits like a truck, too.
Oh, yeah. I will say anybody who, like, consistently uses a bow, I would say, is someone you should fear. Typically, there was, I forget, it was like a Gambit match I was running around, and it was like Gambit, no, it was comp, not even Gambit, it was comp. And there was a point where I went up, and it's PC, so the player base isn't the biggest. A couple times I came across a pair of guys, and they were running both using bows. I was like, you're using comp at like Fabled level. I should be scared. Like, because if you're using a bow at that level, I need to turn and run, because you are skilled if you're actually choosing to use it at that level. So that's talent right there. So, and man, on console, I can only imagine it's even harder to hold the trigger and then get that like pull at the right time. So, I mean, I'm sure
you can't really challenge bows, man. If you're like in a lane and they hit you can't pop out, you're done. Like,
no,
bows got a lot of control, man.
Mm-hmm.
They can hit you in the toe after that first shot and you're toast. So. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, so well, happy to have you here with us. Yeah, honestly, just looking forward to watching you continue to grow, and obviously looking forward to meeting you at GuardianCon, because we will be there too. So, that is gonna be a week late from today. Actually, it starts. It'll almost be going live. I think it opens at like 10. It opens up, but it'll be Friday next week. So, how many GuardianCons have you been to, CoolGuy? Because I know we're all kind of different in attendance here.
This is my third year straight.
Nice.
I went to my first one, and I'm never not coming. Put it that way.
Very cool. Very nice. Cool. Yeah, as we said, we met on one 3 years ago, so it'll be... Is it three or four?
I'm trying to think. That's a good question, because I know last
year... Because there were two in the middle I haven't done, so this would be... Yeah. So it's the fourth?
Fourth, right? Yeah, I think
this feels that sounds weird, but yeah, I missed two in the middle from after we met,
right?
And you've been to...
I've been to one after the one I met you, okay? So I've been to two totally, and this one will be my third.
Nice,
mm-hmm. Yeah. The first one that I went to was Daddy Fat Snaps and Bones. You guys remember that one?
Yeah,
that was awesome. That was the first one I went to. Nice. That was at the Crystal Tournament.
Yeah,
very cool. Nice. That must have been the one you went to, I think, because that would have been the year after I did. So,
yep, that was when I went to Daddy Fat Stacks. Yep, it was that Crucible 20. They had the arcade machines. It was old Tampa Fairgrounds. Yeah, man, good stuff.
Yeah, we got an upgrade. So woo! I don't know. Yeah, the Rosen Shingle Creek, this resort we're going to, man. It's seriously like everything is there. It's all indoors, which is amazing. Like, it's all walking distance. Mm-hmm. So I know, like, we'll be there a couple days afterwards for sure, because my wife and I are gonna hang out, go to like Universal one day. We're gonna do as much Harry Potter stuff as we can in one day. Nice. And then I think the other day we might just chill. But like, what are you guys getting any extra time out there? I think yours is it's like CoolGuy.
Hey, can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We end up getting a condo on a lake, dude, and I really enjoy fishing.
Oh, nice.
I already told my wife, like, here's the deal, man, because it's like a 30-second walk down the lake. I'm going to go straight to, like, a sporting store, grab a fishing rod. Like, that's going to be my thing for a little bit. But she wants to do Universal. We did that last year, and that's a blast all in itself, dude.
Nice.
Or, like, the big thing is going to Epcot for 4th of July. Like, I'm really considering that. Everyone says that's the jam.
Nice.
I could see that being insane. We get in at like 6, so I have no idea what it would be like to get in, check in, and still trying to get over there. I'm sure it's just absolute bonkers, but...
That'd be insane. Sunday, we're doing Halo Outpost. I don't know if you guys are doing that.
Oh, funny you said that. I didn't know it was going on concurrently. Yeah, I was thinking about it, because I was like, do I have enough time? Because it was right in that window. What day are you going? I mean, what time are you going?
So... We'll probably get there first thing Sunday morning, because the con's Friday, Saturday.
Right.
And Halo Outpost Saturday, Sunday. But pro tip, I think on Groupon, you can go and get like 20% off of a ticket.
let me check that out.
We're over here like Googling stuff in the podcast. I'm sorry, what's going on?
Cool guy giving outside of Destiny help. I'm loving this.
Yeah, man. I mean, and I would hope that some of the Bungie devs go to that.
Oh, there's no way they don't, I feel like.
Yeah.
I'm sure they will be all over that type of stuff. It's their game. I mean, that's their... What's their other major baby that they've made, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, they definitely got to go see. A few of them will. I'm sure how long their trip is, though, because I know they did the community outreach thing for pulling a couple people into the next community summit, and that thing starts, like, real fast. So there's not a lot of downtime, I guess, for some of them. I guess we'll see how much they have.
Yeah,
so I've never been to Bungie. I plan to go. one day. I want to do a studio tour, man, because I think it's just so cool.
You and me both.
Yeah, that's like on a bucket list for me too. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's the hope. I mean, I don't know. You're big enough. At some point, I feel like you'll get the shoulder to the little tap on the shoulder and be like, "Hey, you want to come to this summit? We want your opinion, sir."
Well, we'll see, man. Like, so what's cool about like, because there's so many good, in my opinion, like community leaders. They just recently went on BungieNet and Reddit to take people from each one of those sections to go to the summit upcoming up, which is great.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people get upset, like, well, they don't invite just the average person, and now they are, which is great.
Yeah.
And content creators, man, I tell you what, like, video, and I'll have 800,000 comments. So like, and I read them all, and I'm sure like the big people, you know, your true vanguards, they get a lot more than they read those. So mm-hmm. like, feel on what how their community feels, right? So, mm-hmm. Invite it out. Mm-hmm.
You there?
Maybe one day you're cutting out a little.
You might
bit,
be, yeah. You might be cutting in and out a little bit.
Cutting it out just a little bit.
Is that better?
Yep.
Yeah. So far, yeah. Sounds clear. Much better. Sounds clearer.
Mm-hmm. Say, well, let me know.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, maybe one day for me, but you know, a lot of content creators kind of, I mean, they follow the game obviously, and they have a good pulse on how their community feels. Like I have a Discord, man, and I made that on a whim just to help players find games to try to get Luna's Howl.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I never used Discord in my entire life, dude. This thing looks pretty cool, right? This whole Discord thing. So I made this thing. I put it in a video. I said, hey, you know, we're gonna do this specifically to find games because I know finding games are going as a solo player can be rough, and it's a lot easier. I mean, even if it's just me, like the connection that you guys have is me, at least you have something to talk about, and hopefully you guys can become friends and start running some comp together, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And 2,500 people are there. I'm like, okay.
Wow, that's awesome.
Oh, I had to get admins. Like, I had it set up to where, like, anytime anybody said anything, everyone got a ping, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, everyone's phones have, like, you know, 8,000 notifications. Oh, my God.
You're like, hold on. All right, I got to figure this out now. It's too big.
Mm-hmm. But I do, right? So, and I have some great mods in there, and I have some great, I mean, and just great discussions. And now it's over like 4,000 people. And it's just kind of my thing now. I didn't think it would be a thing, but it's a thing. It's awesome.
That's really cool, man.
That's cool, man. Seeing that growth. I think I actually joined because of that. I remember when you put that out there. You're like, hey, buddy, you needs any help? And you had a couple of rooms open. I'm like, hey, let me jump in there. I was trying to get the my Luna's grind on Xbox at the time.
Oh, yeah, that grind was a pain. Thank that invitation for kicking me off, and then I ended up getting just spending way too much time in comp after that. So I've never been as much of a comp player. I know Cognito's over there just like, come on. Come on, let's go. That's my jam. Let's get in there.
I love it, man. I love it.
And it was that last invitation of the nine where you had to do the Rumble, quick play, and competitive. I played the three competitive. I was like, I know I'm on like the low man totem pole, like zero glory score. Let's try. And then I jumped in and I ended up getting like a 5 streak between like a few extra matches probably than that. And I was at like 1,000. I'm like, well, crap, I'm halfway to Fabled. So then there I actually started looking for, I was like, okay, now I got to figure out, see if there's any places out there. And I think it was CG, he posted about his server too, so I ended up jumping in his because I must have missed your memo. Mm-hmm. And just jumped in there, had a little help on two different sessions and ended up getting it. But I was like, now I'm kind of got like the itch for comp now. It's like,
yep.
It takes a little bit to get into, and sometimes it is definitely absolutely brutal. And when I was getting, like, I played some games with CG, and it was just like, on their team, I'm just like, I would be the solo guy, I know, if I wouldn't have been with them, going against them, just watching my glory go down quicker and quicker. So it's like, that's where I would have been. But then it's like, if you can get some help and play together, it's like, it is like, comp is cool. And that's one thing you said, like, for a shooter, when the space magic is flying and everything is kind of at its, like, at the peak and things are going and you're talking and you're in those moments, it's still hard to compete with this game. Even in something where it's like, I know people want trials and things aren't perfect, but man, there are some moments in this game that are just like, can't really get touched by too much else. It's so much fun.
Yeah, fair enough. And I think a good point in conjunction with what you said is just that, like, you know, when I watch, you know, CoolGuys video, I think you had a video in reference to you know, as far as what needs to happen with comp, you know, and just PvP in general. And I know maps was a focus and some other things.
That's a big
but
one.
Yeah, one of the things that you said that's really cool is that if you're playing right now, you truly love PvP. You know, say like you truly love, because obviously it's not in the space that it needs to be. So again, they got that foundation. And if they go course correct and just add the things that the community is wanting, and you know, hopefully we'll get a little bit of that with Shadowkeep. It could, you know, it could really rise again, because we all know, you know, what Trials did for it back in the past, and just some basic structure changes. Yeah, it'll be really, really good to see.
So I wanted to actually ask you, since we're kind of on this topic anyway, and it seems very perfect to just like stick this one in here. So in the fall, they talked about, like, obviously PvP, they've even acknowledged like the kind of neglect for maps and modes and changes and things like that. So when they say they want to work on playlists and kind of foundational type stuff is kind of what it seems they've alluded to in the fall. What are things for you, like, what are your kind of top three things that you want to see? And you may have said this already in the video, but just kind of quick rundown that you would see, like, that'll make a PvP experience better for you, both PC, console. I mean, cross-save and all that stuff is great, but it's like, what's going to make that PvP take it to the next level that you want to come along with all the other stuff we got coming?
So it depends on what route they go, because, I mean, they specifically said that this next season's going to have a lot of Crucible in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
The whole thought process was, I mean, it's been 8 months, 9 months, a year, and if you're not really going to give it a love, at least give something back a little bit. And, like, I'm to the point, I think a lot of players are, like, I was talking about with the maps, like, bring back Widow's Court, bring back Rusted Lands, like, just port them right over. I mean, they're different engines, and they have to do some stuff to it, but, like, the assets are there, just kind of remake it, throw it in, we're happy. Just do that, right? Mm-hmm. But, I mean, it sounds like they're doing that. We saw Widow's Court in the Vidoc.
Mm-hmm.
They're bringing back Elimination. That was a big deal. For me, like, when they talk about competitive Destiny and, you know, what was really nice about Iron Banner, let's just kind of jump off real quick. I mean, Iron Banner is the first time in Destiny 2 that a PvP activity grants enhanced armor.
Yes.
Yes.
And it kind of went unnoticed. Mm-hmm. So obviously, that's the best armor in the game. You'd get it from raids. You get it from Reckoning, things like that. But there never was any kind of activity. So, like to me, that kind of showed me, okay, maybe they're starting to pay a little attention to it, right?
Right.
Because that's an entirely different community. Like, as an example, my wife, she's, you know, believe it or not, she's pretty good at games, right? She,
nice.
She's over 2KD in Call of Duty, right? So she has some issues because she strictly loves the Crucible. She doesn't really, she hates jumping puzzles. Like, that's not her jam. So, like, all the new raids, of course, are focused on jumping puzzles.
Sounds like, and, like, my brother.
Mm-hmm.
She's like, I'm done. Just do it for me. She'll put the controller down.
It sounds like me with the jumping puzzles. Continue.
Got that warlock floof. You know,
we need to get you on a Blast Furnace. We need to get you on a Bygones. So, you know, on console, you'd really like it. She's like, but I got to play Gambit, right? So it's like, she's like just powering through Gambit, right? So there are people that just love PvP. And I know, like, a lot of people in my Discord, like, they play it 95% of the time. They don't even have some of the best guns because they just don't go into PvE. Mm-hmm. That's their thing. It's unfortunately, there's a lot of good PvE content in the game. Like, I love PvE, and I just don't cover that much on my channel, but...
Yeah.
Back to that main question.
Oh, no, you're in the perfect place. Like, when you want to talk about tangents and offshoots and, like, wrong talks for 30... Yeah, you're in a good spot. You're totally fine.
So, there is a PvP community, right? And way back in the day, they had, like, the MLG tournament. I don't know if you guys remember that. Like, Luminosco.
Yeah, I remember that. Yes.
Like, I honestly believe that there's always been an interest for, like, higher-end Destiny play. So, like, they're bringing back Elimination. And to me, like, if they were ever to bring back Trials, it needs to be 3v3 Elimination.
Talk about it. Let's go.
I was like, all right, you got it. Yeah, get it rolling.
Let's get it. Let's talk about it right now.
Listen, it needs to be 3v3 Elimination. It's more of a, what's the word I'm looking for?
Mm-hmm.
Like a closer team comp of three players.
Mm-hmm.
4v4, but there's a lot of things to me that needs to change. And they've already talked about it, right? Reducing super health, heavy ammo needs to be addressed. Right. And I'm to the point of one of my big things that I hope that they change is heavy ammo.
Mm-hmm.
And just one time a game, everybody has their fun. Everyone goes to the thing, six people in quick play or one round. Mm-hmm. And everybody has their fun for 15 seconds and then it's over. Because in Destiny 2, I mean, if you haven't noticed, if you go on the Crucible, you'll be on a great streak, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I'm like, okay, you're in your spawn with rockets. I don't know how that happened, but it did. That's just, I mean, just little things like that they can touch on. And of course, you know, fix and recoil on console, man.
Oh, yeah, big time. Let me back you up a second, CG, because I wanted to ask you about what you specifically mentioned, 3v3 elimination. And me and you are on the same exact page for that, right? But I want to get to the part about Bungie's thought process. Remember, they came out with a TWAB and they were like, look, you know, in this day and age, as of right now, you know, when people were clamoring for trials, they were saying that they don't feel that it would translate well. And I got to be honest with you, CG, like, I struggled with that comment because part of me is saying, you know, this is when Destiny was kind of at its pinnacle, PvP, and that was, you know, the streamers and the community was behind it, and, you know, you had your boons, and you were going through the whole thing with, you know, Charles Osiris. So it's like, I guess, like, how did you feel personally when you heard that statement? And then if they're not going to bring it back in that form, what else could they do to kind of bring trials to that level again?
Thought about it too, right, when they said that, because I'm thinking, I mean, trials in Destiny 1 kept Destiny going, right?
Continue. I'm gonna be clapping a lot when you talk. Continue.
Oh yeah, you got a super fan over here.
80,000-100,000 Twitch viewers, right? For Crafty and like all Luminosity and all these people. Because what's so cool about trials is player and the PvE player, not even talking about streaming, because you know, like on my side, I'd have some really strong PvE players help me out with raids. Well, I'm like, let me take you through trials, right? So like it's like, you do this for me, I'll do this for you.
Exactly. There you go. Little exchange.
Even if you didn't really like it, it was really fun to watch. So I started thinking, they made Trials in Destiny 2 4v4. They had like little intros, but there was things like Countdown, right? Then it was, you know, primary versus primary. And I've always wondered like how it would be introduced with, you know, the system that we have now. But they have Vicarious Visions and other studios. And Vicarious Visions did a lot for this game. Like, I don't think, like, they made Mormine. They made so many different things for Destiny 2. So I'm thinking, well, Bungie's got to be working on something, right? And at some point, if we're being real here, Destiny kind of fell off. Forsaken brought it back just way back in the day, like Taken King, right?
Right.
Yep. And I think that their separate communities, PvE and PvP, if they were just bringing trials back, let's say tomorrow, it wouldn't do justice for the game. Like, it would make the PvP community happy,
right?
Is they need to bring it back with something like Forsaken, right? Like, that'll keep coming up. It needs to be a huge expansion, or like I said, they're having this you know, cross save Stadia, a whole bunch of influx of players. Like, that's when they need to drop it, because they can't just do it now, in my opinion. It would be a failing thing.
Completely agree. So to follow up with that, when, because me and E have had this question, you know, he posed it to me, like, with Shadowkeep, with so much going on, you know, obviously, like you said, cross save and, you know, all these new features and stuff like that, and new light, and the population will be high, you know, is it asking too much, you think, at for Shadowkeep, or maybe we have to wait for like the next part of the annual pass before we get trials again?
I think it'd be way, way later on, dude. Because and they made a commitment and saying, you know what, our studio can make, you know, seasons of content coming up with the next annual pass, right?
Right.
Like I said before, like, those studios did a lot, man. Like, they did so much. Like, I remember looking back, and I forget what it was for you, but like an early Destiny 1, like 2014, 2015 concept art, Mars looks exactly like Venus now, if that makes sense.
Wow.
But basically what happened is Vicarious Visions came along and they made Mars. Mm-hmm. And with their Mars, they made it Venus. So like, if you look at the concept art for Destiny 1, it's Venus but brown, right?
Nice.
So weird how it all went down, right? And the whole Activision thing. But I do think that they're going to commit to building their promises now of, you know, getting content out, like they're getting ready to come out with the moon. Like, they need to get all that done before they put something like that on their plate, in my opinion.
Fair enough.
Yeah, so I had asked Cognito as well, kind of curious your thoughts on this one. So the way the seasons have gone previously, well, yeah, there's a lot of questions I can ask you. We'll see how many we get to, but this will be one. So the way the seasons have gone, we had Black Armory in the Forge, and that was kind of PvE. Then we had Season of Drifter, which was mostly Gambit. And then we had, obviously, Opulence was kind of back to more PvE. If they did some cadence like that again, how do you think the overall... Do you think it would be, like, fitting, fair, good, bad, or otherwise if they did a season... Say it was, like, Shadowkeep, another season, and then, say, like, your March or your springtime where Drifter landed, if it was, like, a season of trials? Like, do you think... That would actually, how do you think that would go over? And do you think that would be a decent place to let it land?
Is it of the Red Jacks, y'all?
That would be fire.
Jax's storyline with the Red Jacks.
Now, I gotta be honest though, it's fire as that would be for us because we love our PvP. Now, one of the negatives to Season of the Drifter was that it was so Gambit focused, and if you didn't like Gambit. That season wasn't for you. So do you think they can get away? I mean, we'll be smiling. Me and you, we'll be like,
I don't think so, man. It would have to be an add-on, just like Trials would have to be an add-on. Like, it would have to be with something.
Yeah, because I think if they have a whole season of just PvP, people are riot. They're not going to be able to hear. I'll see E's face. He'll be like, oh, another one. I got to get
Hey, tried. I'm getting better about this. I'd be on board. I've slowly been working on my sniper kills a lot slower than a lot of people for my slow... kills, and then I'll work on Revoker, but it'll happen eventually. So,
no doubt.
I like that they're doing the buy-in model for the seasons and the pass itself. I'm obviously gonna get all the seasons. I genuinely love the game, right? Mm-hmm. But what I do, if you haven't noticed, when they're done with content, they're done. But what I hope one day they get to a point as or to where the like we'll take Black Army, dude. Like I like Black Army. It was the first time you could actually select a weapon, go in, farm said weapon.
Yes.
Imagine Black Army comes out, then we have Season of the Drifter and Network Opulence, and Opulence is amazing.
Yeah, I like it so far.
What if you know Season of Opulence comes out? You see the patch notes, and they're like, okay, rifle to Black Army, right? We added this sniper rifle, like. As all these seasons go on, like those are such good things, right? I think Black Army is such a good thing for the game. Like, why not add a couple weapons to that with the content drop that you're getting ready to do? That gives you reason to go back to the forges. Does that make sense?
I see exactly.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, so, Cognito, you've been playing Black Army right now, haven't you?
I've been playing a lot of Black Army. It's so funny you said that because, like I said, I got into it a little late. And I started working on certain quests and like just a little late, you know what I'm saying? But what it is to be honest, the real reason why I won't get back into it, I'm a type of person that like to have diversified weapons, you know, whenever the meta changes, I'm prepared. So if the meta goes one way, okay, boom, I got my blast furnace god roll here, I got this going on here, I got my if Izignami, you know, with the catalyst now, you know, I'm ready to go. So if anything in the meta shifts, I got something as a backup. So that was primarily my reason for playing. But as I'm doing it and I'm like, I like CG said, like I like being able to grind specifically for what I want. Like that gameplay loop and then going to the fort, it's actually cool. It's a you know, kind of mindless activity, jumping there. You don't really need matchmaking, just three, you know, and you kind of knock yourself out. So I like it. You know, I personally like it. And I think it's something, your suggestion is actually something very cool I would actually like as well.
Yeah, man. Mm-hmm. Like all these past seasons, I just hope that they add on to. But I know that, I mean, they have a lot on their plate. I think that they're doing a good job for everything that's going on, dude. Like they're the captains of their own ship now with Activision being gone. And if you haven't noticed, I mean, like Luke Smith's making blog posts, like a lot of people are talking that never talked before.
Yes. It's refreshing. You saw it from the VidOc. Like as soon as the VidOc dropped, me and E, we noticed it immediately, right? E, we were just like, man, like you can sense it. You can sense them being themselves and molding Destiny the way they want it. The minute they talked about no more exclusive content anymore and everyone playing together, all inclusive. Love the talk, man.
That's the most exciting thing, man. Like I think that the true vision of Destiny is getting ready to come out over the next year.
Facts.
And at least the blueprint of it. And you know, they said they want to touch on it for 2-3 more years and maybe Destiny 3. It doesn't really matter as long as they keep updating the game. The Destiny community is very, very passionate about the game. Mm-hmm. And you know, people are talking about, you know, Destiny's isn't gonna die, dude. Like
no.
And like, so Anthem came out, that was supposed to be a Destiny killer, et cetera. Whoa!
Oh, he talking that talk right now. Oh, yeah. Talking, CG. Oh, I like this Destiny talk he talking right now.
Well, like, so a lot of, like, I have friends that still play Anthem, dude. I was looking the other day, there's like 280 total players on Xbox for Anthem. Like, it's horrendous, but I never hate on someone for liking a game, right? I mean, that's what gaming's for. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, it's a hobby, it's a passion, and if you like something, dude, you know, rock on. Yeah. But like with Destiny, like with what they're doing, I think it's gonna have longevity, right? Yeah. So I'm pretty excited for what they're getting ready to do.
One last point, and I'll jump on what you said, is that you're so right, because, you know, I've seen it, you know, on social media, as soon as the next big game comes out, we hear it all the time, Destiny killer, right? And to me, I'm like, easy, easy. Don't do that to that game. You know what I'm saying? We've seen it. And, like, Division's probably the closest right now as far as I feel competing. But at the end of the day, and E, we've talked about all the time, when it comes down to that gunplay, right? The feel of web, just basic fundamentals. And then, you know, even now you see Division, they doing a raid, and they're having their little issues and stuff like that as far as balancing, things like that. But there's one thing, you know, to be doing something like a raid, to say you're doing it, and then there's another thing to actually execute and then have that fictional world where it kind of makes sense. And it's just, the mechanics are just on another level. So it, to me, what I realized that even at Bungie, when they're at their lowest, or Destiny's at its lowest, the core gameplay is so good. That's why we remain loyal to the game. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? It's just so good. So I think it's one of those things that, unless they completely, you know, screw up and say F their community or do something crazy, which I don't envision having, especially now they are on their own from Activision, you know, the future's bright. And I think we get, maybe by D3, we get, you know, cross play. You know what I'm saying? Now we're getting cross save. You know, I think next gen or whatever, you know, it's going to be really exciting times for the future. And look at the player count, right? Over 1 million. Active people are excited. This game, no matter how many times it's down, it always rises back. And it's cool to see.
Yeah.
They're pretty smart about it, too, man. So there's a whole bunch of stuff that probably happened behind closed doors with Activision that we'll never know. And honestly, I mean, that's their deal. But it feels like, it looks like, you know, the whole game was kind of held down because of that partnership, right? Yeah. And they needed that partnership, which is weird, because they were with Microsoft, one of the biggest publishers in the world, said, nah, we're good. We're going to go to Activision because Activision has the reach. Mm-hmm. Activision can go to PlayStation. And then they did PC, right, with Blizzard.
Yes.
So now they leave Activision to partner with Stadia. Like, it's just kind of weird how they all do it. But it's all for the growth of the game. Like, Stadia is going to be huge.
Mm-hmm.
But I think now they're in a position to where the game can actually start thriving with their vision. And mm-hmm. I think they're doing a good job.
Absolutely, man. Mm-hmm. What else you got, E?
No, we're just kind of hitting random stuff as we kind of go through. So I know we've got Shadowkeep coming in the fall with a lot of stuff. For you, are there any major changes that you've seen? Whether, I mean, I know mine, there were a couple things just when they were doing the Vidoc. And I think, as you guys were saying it too, before the Vidoc even started, that stream, when it was just Luke and Mark talking, and I think that was the part where he was just, their feeling of just like, candid, hey, we're shooting this stuff with you right now, we're going through these bullet points, I've got my list, and like Luke's just being all like, those two talking when they're talking, it's like they seem like the perfect pair to keep each other in check. Luke is just like, you know, just kind of has like fun. Mark's like, he's gonna like hit down his bullet points, and those two kind of like, Mark seems like he may keep Luke in check, Luke probably has Mark think out of the box and stuff like that, and those two seem like a really awesome pair. Like, just to watch those two work would be really cool. But like, when they started, oh yeah, they're having a blast now. And now, and when they started that stream, just the way their whole, and this, what both of you guys said, is that they started it as just like, okay, it's like they're free, they took off all the shackles and everything, and they're just like, all right, what's up? And it was just like the coolest I've seen them be to start any of their streams ever. And just everything they said after that, like, for me, like, big stuff has been like Armor 2.0, them saying the MMO more, like those type of things. Ooh. Like, what for, like, those were just like music to my ears. So for anything they talked about in the fall, like, what are one or two big things that you're really looking forward to? I know, like, the PvP, like, foundational shift is obviously one, but is there anything that you've seen so far that you're kind of pumped about?
Yeah, well, that's just like, that's probably my personal number one, right? So we won't even like recognize that because that's obvious.
Yeah.
I, as you saw, like, Intellect Discipline Strength's coming back, so that tells me they're probably going to do something about super mods and certain mods, either just discontinue them or whatnot. But I think building the character around how you want, like Discipline Strength, which was so good, and then capping that is a good way for an overall player feel. And then, of course, you know, having any armor that you want to have the perks that you want on it, right?
Mm-hmm. Transmog, baby.
Transmog is huge. And just the way you could, like, I still want to understand Armor 2.0, because they're, like, picking perks, and you have, like, 8 or max of, like, 10 energy that you can apply towards said perks. Like, that's the stuff I want to hear about, and they're going to be tight-lipped until they're ready. But, man, I can't wait to hear about that stuff for me.
Like, it's such a small thing, but it's a big thing, because every single, like, in this game right now, if you're running enhanced perks, I mean, aside from the new Iron Banner that just came out, like, it was always you're running raid gear or you're running Dreaming City gear. Back in Destiny 1, to be high enough light, everyone was running around with the Vault of Glass gear, right? Forever 29.
Yes.
Remember
God. Yeah.
Same. By the way, Chatterwhite needs to come back.
Salute, Chatterwhite.
I was Forever 29. My buddy was 30 so fast, and I got screwed for a while. So I feel that.
And hopefully one day they do an apply all shader that just consumes 5 of them.
Thank you.
And your entire Guardian is in that shader.
Nice.
Yeah, full preview and apply all, and then like weapons and armor, like you just want your weapons, bam. Those could be separate. Yeah, apply all to armor would be so nice. Those little things, like that's the type of stuff we're seeing with like the universal ornaments in Eververse, the changes for Bright Dust and like the way those purchases are going to work and stuff. Like all these things, everybody was like, oh, we don't know if Activision, soon as they get done with Activision, they're like, okay, bam, change this. Like we're seeing a lot pretty quick. That's kind of surprisingly telling.
Like they said they had cross.
Sorry, go ahead.
So they've had cross save ready for like a year.
Yeah, they wanted to do it for the longest. Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's
No. You're good. And that's those types of things. It's like we're finally getting a little more. And even in the when they're doing the stream, is like, yeah, and all these things because of reasons in big giant quotes and stuff like that. That they're doing. Yeah. I'm sorry. I gotta clear my throat. It's that I got that sore throat going on. But those types of things, it's like no one. Everybody was always like, well, Bungie's doing some things. And we know Bungie made some calls. Like, I still wonder when D2 launched with the whole two primaries. Was this, like, Activision Bungie? Like, no one knows those type of decisions. Yeah. Like, those are questionable. But when it comes to stuff like Eververse and things, and the changes you see them make so quickly have been quite telling of the things they do get control over, which have been really nice to see. So, no, I just want to walk around to like everybody at Bungie and shake their hand and be like, man, it's like it's been an amazing 5 years, and it sounds like we're just getting started.
Yeah,
exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, well, that's a whole lot of rambling about just a whole bunch of stuff just to get our podcast started, but that's how we do it. So, you are totally fine. Our podcast was called Flashpoint before, and then we did a little name searching and actually found we weren't the only one, so we switched it over to this. Figured out we still weren't the only one, but talked to
Scarrow9
over there. Yeah, he actually retweeted this thing too. Because he actually had done kind of a last word chat discussion thing, but he hadn't done in a while, so we let him take up the mantle. And then also shout out to, what is it, Lawrence O'Donnell on MSNBC, who has the exact same name. So we're like, okay, we can't win, but we stuck with this. But it was called Flashpoint before, but we usually would joke that it was called Longpoint.
Longpoint.
Because it was never a flash in the pan. It was always like, we would be a 2-hour podcast.
Quick about that podcast. No.
You're always long-winded, so that's when you're like, if you get off on it, like, no, you're in a great spot, so. But yeah, so this week, obviously, a couple big things happened. We had Heroic Menagerie launch, so that is one of the biggest ones. Have you jumped in there and checked it out and kind of kicked its butt yet, or have you been in there much?
So we did one run, and it was after the raid. We're like, dude, let's try Menagerie, and like we had zero team comp. I was the only well, right? And we went in there, and we got to the final boss, and we ended up wiping. We're like, okay, we'll just try it again another day, which would be today.
Oh, okay.
And between my friends and I, like, that's always the thing, right? I'm like, well, when we're talking about 5 or 6 man and something, obviously, like, a full raid team, right? We're like, okay, well, we need to have this, Swarm of the Raven, and you need to have this. And then it all comes down to this, like, well, solo it. We'll be just fine, right? Like that's always the answer with everything that we do.
just go for it.
For it. If Glad can solo it, we'll be fine. And he's almost done soloing, man. He's gotten to the final boss. He's almost figuring it out. So, and that guy's just amazing. I don't know if you guys ever watch Glad.
Oh,
he's
yeah.
Beast.
He's crazy.
Oh, yeah.
There's no excuses. Experience, man. Nice. It's a really fun experience, Menagerie. I mean, of course, I didn't get to complete it, but there's a chance for the Burden Catalyst and then the Masterwork Weapon. So,
absolutely.
So, what do you think of? Okay, first I want to touch on like the rewards for Heroic. Basically, we're seeing, I guess you get a chance to get a curated piece of armor, it seems like. I don't know if it'll be a curated role, but it's like a full masterwork piece of armor if you get it that way. And then I think people are still kind of testing to see if they get a curated role or a guaranteed. And then you have the chance at the swords. For as difficult as Menagerie can be or potentially could be for some, do you think adding a couple things and maybe like one curated is worth it for some? Or how do you feel? Because now it's like you're almost talking about a full match made raid if you're taking six people in there. It's not the full length, but it is definitely putting in some work. And some of the like modifiers this week are Blackout and Iron, and people are like, please don't put me in Riposte, like stuff like that. How do you think it feels for what we're getting out of it? Do you think the rewards justify the difficulty, I guess is the best way to say it?
I'd have to complete it more, but it's kind of tough to say. Like currently with the chest glitch, which I mean, it's unfortunate it's getting patched, right? Like,
that's topic two. We're getting there.
But yeah. Like, you know, that's right. It's like, well, if like it kind of feels like it should be a little bit more. Maybe throw in some regular armor mods in there or something, okay. Or maybe just because that whole entire loot pool, like Dustrock, Erentil, like it's all in there. Maybe throw one of those weapons there on top, right?
That'd be cool.
A little bit more or a better chance, because we all know like you can get a weapon all you want, but if it doesn't have the right perks, it's done.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of them go in the trash.
And you could look out into a nice curated role, but other than that, maybe a little bit more for how much time it's going to take, because it'll take 25-30 minutes probably.
Yeah, and if you wipe a couple times and get halfway through, that's like a good hour and a half. Or it's like, just like yeah.
If you're like my raid team that takes an hour, right? It's even worse.
Yeah, that's all right. So that's one of the big topics that happened, obviously, is Heroic Menagerie dropped. We know a couple swords have been dropped out there, and those seem kind of cool, and swords actually seem pretty viable in the raid now for certain pieces. But the big thing is the chest glitch. They call it, a lot of people call it a glitch. We all figured it was a glitch. Now it's been confirmed to actually be a glitch. And we're going to get it patched on the 9th. So, I guess first off for both of you, I want to ask, do you guys think that, like some people could hit it like 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times and get pulls, but then you're still talking about RNG. Where do you think, like Bungie, are they doing the right thing? Do you think it should just be one pull? Is there a middle ground? What do you guys feel? And I'll drop it to you first, cool guy, just to see. What do you feel about this whole glitch? Where do you think it should be? Do you think they're doing the right thing?
Leave it up to the community to find something like that, right? Oh, but like, yeah. I man, because you're so accustomed now to going in, especially if you have your chalice up, like you can hit some of the chests 6 times and then you'll double up on some. So you'll come up with like 9 weapons, which is I mean, it's comical. Comical when you really think about it, but just getting one weapon and then with a perk of possibility of 2. And then we've all seen the rolls, right? You get an, say you get an Awestringer that's full max ability with Zen Moment. And I don't know, maybe it's not what you want. Well, that's 15, 20 minutes that probably they make like 2 or 3 possible pulls with it. I think would be just about right. Like I think for the time you spend with the content, 2 or 3 sounds just about right.
Fair enough. I could see that. That's one thing I think I've heard in a couple places, but what about you, Cognito?
Yeah, I mean, it's tough because, you know, I'm late again. I was at an E3, so I'm not playing catch up. I finally played Menagerie. So, first off top, love it. I do love it. I mean, I think the thing that attracts me right now is the 6-man cooperative aspect. You know, match made. It's literally like, you know, mini raid light. You know what I'm saying? I love that aspect. There's some light mechanics. And I actually think it's something they need to continue to do going forward because it will encourage people to do raids, I feel. When you have more lighter mechanics like how this has, you know, it's just so much fun. You know, we beat the boss, then I saw people doing the treasure chest glitch. I'm like, where are they going? What's going on here? I saw the back and forth. I'm like, oh, okay, I see. But, you know, in reference to your question, you know, I struggle with, listen, Destiny players, we're going to find stuff, you know? So I get it, but I think it obviously wasn't intended that way. And then obviously once we start getting our god rolls and we start blazing through, I'm worried that, you know, it will shorten this content, you know, and this is part of that grind. So, you know, I hate to be the fun police, but I think they do got to reel it in. You know what I'm saying? I have to disagree with my boy CG on this one. Listen, you got one run, man. You got get your one run, you get your reward, and then you get out. But I think they want you to keep playing. And I'm just worried that if we keep grinding and we keep putting our hand in the cookie jar so many times, that you're going to have everything, and then it's like, okay, we're going to stop playing again. I personally don't. So that's just me. That's my
Yeah, I was like, for me, it's kind of like I'm somewhere in the middle ground. I think it would be nice to see them do a way to balance, like, rewarding higher level play. So okay. If there's a way for you to get through, like if you just kind of are like, okay, we get like 70%, okay, if you fail the encounters but get to the boss, maybe that's one pull. But maybe say your group is like, you're really fast, but you hit two perfectly, you finish up that third, you hit your bar, and then you go do the boss, you might get one or two extra pulls for doing it well, especially as we get higher level and things like that, it will get easier to do those types of things. And then if the skill actually gives you some benefit of reward, that would be some way. And somewhere in that middle ground is what I would kind of like to see, is 2 to 3, or doing an encounter well if you finish one completely, getting something extra. Because if you go through and you spend 30 minutes and it's like, I mean, a lot of the roles that we get are questionable anyway. If you go run strikes or a whole bunch of stuff is usually just crap anyway that we get. So if we get a chance to at least steer one or two of these roles that we get, whether it's a piece of armor, and it's only like 2 or 3, you still got to go spend some time in there. And then taking that to the next level when you get to heroic, like that one needs to have something, whether it's like specifically a chance at like extra mods, or somebody even said it in chat, like talking about the sniper, like actually having the mod separate or something would be a really cool way to do that. But I just like to see, and I think that's one thing a lot of, even the raid itself, people have been just saying, it's like, yeah, you can get armor that has some enhanced perks, but the weapons are, you know, there's not much really coming from the raid right now. So, and I think it's just they've got to, for the fall especially, I'd like to see, like, all these concepts are cool. The 6-person matchmaking, like, then you have the heroic version and the difficulties and stuff. I want the rewards, and that's where, again, the more MMO piece, I want the rewards to start being more worth it as opposed to just one more role.
So. No, I can meet you in the middle there. I can definitely meet you in the middle there. There's, and maybe, like I said, is also have, like, a halfway point where you're rewarded automatic, you know, with a drop, and then the full completion, or, like you said, with the... based on how well the group done, you know, I think they can find a meet.
Yeah, like another pull there would give you like progress, be like, hey, you made it halfway through, you hit that middle bar, okay, cool, after this encounter you get a pull on a chest, like on your path in between, okay, you go finish up the boss, you know, if you did it well, if you did the challenge or something, you may get one or two extra, like stuff like that that they used to do would be nice, just to give you a little more incentive to push. Otherwise, you can just like go random match make. Okay, cool. We finished through. I got my one pull. Like people won't care as much, and there won't be incentive to actually like excel. I feel like.
Fair enough.
Cool guy, you still there?
Hear me okay?
Nah, you're cutting again. You're doing like the cutting in and out.
Kind of thing. I wonder why it does that. I'm sorry.
No, cool. You're good. Sometimes I always wonder if, like, Discord for, like, volume thresholds and stuff like that. I've got to keep mine fairly close, too, so. But no, that's, like, one of the biggest questions is, I think, right now, what this is going to do to Season of Opulence. Because everybody started, and, like, Opulence was, like, on high, raid contest, Menagerie came out, the loot grind's been good, they've added a couple bosses, Heroic got the Catalyst and stuff like that, but now we're kind of at the point of, we're going to get Lumina next week, which we don't know much about, by the way. They have a bit of a tease in there as to what is to come, how they describe it, basically. Where's the wording on that in the TWAB? I'm actually looking for it.
I actually have it in the article I wrote.
Oh, there you go.
So, well, lordsgaming.net. Yeah, they use some verbiage basically saying guardians wielding this weapon to support each other in combat. So it's kind of, that's the only kind of clue they've given, obviously, besides go to the EDZ and look for it. Yeah. But I'm getting a support vibe based on that. So we'll see. I mean, the design looks cool. I mean, I'm dying to know. Yes, it's another damn hand cannon, but I am very curious about this one.
You know, the year of hand cannons.
Yeah, it's hand cannon central out here.
I think we're going to have all the hand cannons. Like next year, no more hand cannons. Mm-hmm. I mean, I enjoy them too, just like anybody, but there's a point for like exotics. Like, when's the last exotic pulse?
Yeah. Or, well, you know, yeah, we say outbreak.
That was it. That was not new, but it was a technically an exotic pulse.
True.
What about an exotic sidearm, man? Come on. No, I'm just kidding. So that's actually a question.
We need
for
one
you.
More hand, though. That'll be the last one, and then we can just move on. But
yeah. Hawk moon, and then call it a day.
Yeah, give me my Hawk moon, and I'll be happy. Mm-hmm. I miss Hawk moon.
Yeah.
If you're on Xbox, go ahead.
No, I was going to say a quick question for both of you. Yeah. Let's start with you first. What exotic do you want to return, Bradley? If you had to rank one, you know, what exotic is not here from D1 that you really want back?
And you got to ask that's not going to break the game is a giant caveat.
No. If not about break the game, just what you want. What do you want?
For ones that I had like a special place for in certain moments, like I was never that good with it, but I always loved Hawk Moon when I got to enjoy it. And then also Bad Juju, I have a special place for that one. Like Bad Juju, the ornaments on it always look so cool. It was a quick three burst, and I cannot tell you how many like Prison of Elders guides and things that I did when you need super to come back, that was like, that was my baby a lot of the time when I was running.
Remember that Juju Obsidian Mile Flow?
Oh my God. Yeah, Bad Juju, for a weapon, Bad Juju was really, it was one of the ones that I really miss having, I think, because what it was able to do.
CG, what about you, man?
Oh man, dude, I have so many. I can go on. Like,
let's go.
Let's hear him, man.
Let's hear him, man.
It's so, like non-game breaking. Like the first one that comes to mind is Boolean Gemini. Always felt like now that I know what I know now that Boolean Gemini was made for Destiny 2. Because back, if we remember that it had two perks, it had one way or another. Yep, if you get a headshot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you get a headshot, you get more mobility. If you get a body shot, you get more armor. So, like, that didn't really work in Destiny 1.
Right.
It does work. Because, I mean, maybe it'll max out your stat, right? Mm-hmm. So, I think Boolean Gemini would be good. Mm-hmm. Something like the Tlaloc would be really good.
Oh, that's the one. Yeah. That was my baby right there.
Like, it goes, like, what was it? The
Eye of the Storm, and then it had... man, it was it solar based?
Well, it was overflow. This weapon is better handling, rate of fire, and stability while the wielder super is charged. Like, and it was for solar ones who were saving it, and they actually that was a cool. Like, they had class specific exotics. They haven't done that in Destiny 2 at all. That was the best one, I think. But still,
breath would be good. And I'm also really good or really fine with them reimagining them, like Crimson, right?
Mm-hmm.
Red Death turning into Crimson, or Zalo Supercell with some sort of reimagination, maybe turning like the Boolean Gemini into a sidearm instead of a handgun.
Yeah, almost like a Red Death turned into Crimson kind of a deal.
Yeah, or like you guys remember Hereafter when you got a headshot, it sent a blinding grenade to the area around it. Like I thought that was so cool. Like even in PvP, like.
Okay.
So,
okay. Yeah, those are good ones, man.
What about you? Really? Who asked the question? We gotta get your answer.
It's like CG said, man. So, I mean, you stole my Bad Juju. That was baby. I've been like man. You guys said some good ones. Tlaloc was strong. Most of mine came back. To be honest, like Lord of Wolves, now it's back in crazy form. Sleeper was baby. You know what I'm saying? That was the giant. Damn, what am I forget? You know what? I know one. Vex, Mythoclast. Only because I never got a chance to experience it in D1 when it was at its height, at its pinnacle. So I really want to know what that feeling is, and I would like to see, you know, that kind of brought back. And what was the, what was that one that never came back? It was a fusion that,
Plan C?
Say the name.
Plan C?
Plan C was dope, but no, it was another fusion.
Pocket Infinity.
Pocket Infinity. Yep. There we go. Yep.
That one always had so much potential, too. And it never quite got its heyday.
Yeah.
I will say there's one I'm looking through, like, the list of everything out there right now. I can only imagine what Patience and Time would break in Destiny 2 right now. Because when you, like, go ADS, you go invisible?
Invisible?
Oh, that would be interesting. So that's like, there are some in there, but I'm also, we've got so many D1 exotics in D2. Mm-hmm. At this point, like, they got to outweigh the D. If they bring anything, I want, like, you know, it's got to be like 10 to 2 max. Like, I want a lot more new ones than old ones at this point, because we've had a lot of old stuff come back. Like, half of our armor is basically all D1. So,
absolutely. Honorable mention, Xylo, though.
Xylo. Oh, no.
It's so good.
Every arc burns Xylo Supercell.
Yes.
Just all the things. So
that was like my Thunderlord auto rifle. I love it.
Can I just have my Hung Jury too?
Ooh, remember that? That Dead Orbit one?
Yep.
Damn.
Yep. I miss those
old days, man.
So, but yeah, so Lumina coming. Not entirely sure. You get like 2 days before. You said you're out there. Cool guy, you're out there on the second, so you won't even get to really start that quest, will you?
I know.
It's all right. Like, don't remind me. God.
You sound bitter with that.
He's like, I was like, where's my Stadia puck so I can play on this TV and get progress?
No.
Where's my xCloud so I can do remotely grinding?
So that was interesting. Like, when you said Stadia, you think Stadia is going to go, like, you think Stadia is going to be big. So just out of curiosity, offshoot on tech, since we both are giant nerds as well, what makes you think that about Stadia, just out of curiosity? Because you just got done loving up xCloud, so.
Like, they currently said that Stadia won't be able to play with PC, which, I mean, everyone kind of expected, you would think, right? Mm-hmm. So I would hope that crossplay in the future is going to be happening. But take the new consoles, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the new consoles are going to work as a server.
Mm-hmm.
So you can log into your Xbox from not at your Xbox, essentially. Yep. Maybe you're away, or maybe, like they were saying, like even when they were talking about the new Xbox, maybe you're at Thanksgiving, right? And Xur's coming on and he's selling the Gjallarhorn. You can just kind of log in right there, right?
Oh, yeah.
That, to me, and they always talk about the future, that is the future of gaming. Mm-hmm. Things like that. So Stadia is the first part, and I will be trying it and testing it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be using a controller, because the last mouse and keyboard game I played was like Myst or Oregon Trail.
My babe, CG. Stop that controller bag life. I love it. When he sees me with this.
Yeah, and I'm over there with my actual mouse and keyboard, so.
Yeah.
It's all right. That's all right. Both of you will probably kick my butt anyway, so it's totally fine.
Nah, you good, man. You don't give yourself. No, I'm with it, man. I'm with you, because, you know, just as a tech, we're all geeks here. We all love tech. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We're all excited about this stuff. So for me, you know, being at E3, you know, getting a chance to test xCloud, you know, and like I said, it was literally an elite below with a base and, you know, a Galaxy S10. And I was just thinking, you know, the possibilities, like I said, you're not home. And Stadia still represents something, because the browser aspect, you know, again, you're traveling remotely, you know, you can just log in, essentially just have a controller and still be able to play. So if you don't want to lug a console around, you know, and you got semi-decent, you know, internet, and according to them, you know, they're going to, with your throughput, you get up to resolutions of, they're saying 4K. I got to see. I'll take 1080p. You know?
Yeah, I'll take 1080p.
I'll be good. I'll take 1080p and 60. And think about it. There's so many people who, you know, like you said, CG, like your current rig right now is not, you know, where you want it to be ideally for a you know, Destiny PC spec. So imagine someone who doesn't have a rig, who's working either remotely or just in their own house, and say, hey, I want to play some Destiny. You could just jump in right quick. And I'm just thinking of things to continue the grind when I'm not home. Like, that excites me. Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I will test
the,
it out.
The future, and like, that's their vision, right? To play anywhere, Destiny anywhere. So, like, it's all huge for the game, man.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, my curiosity is going to be, the player base on Stadia. Because as you guys are all saying, it's like, hey, I am in a hotel. Hey, I am out for Thanksgiving. It's like, the Stadia's population biggest on the holidays, and then when you're back home, nobody's on it. Like, because, like, if I can take the puck and the controller with me, it's cool. If I go visit my wife's family and we're up there for a few days, I don't have to lug my computer if I want to do a couple things. Yeah. Can't make videos without it, but that's a different issue. Yeah. But
just think about us all going to GuardianCon, right?
Yeah.
Theoretically, if Stadia was out, right, and the hotel internet is fairly decent, you know.
Cut.
There you go.
Yeah. Be like, hold on. Hey, cool guy. It's like, hold on. Let me plug this into my, like, HDTV in my room here. Got my controller. Hope the connection doesn't suck. Let's go.
Absolutely.
I got my Kindle. No.
Nice.
So it's got, I mean, it's really cool. Like, we're at a point in time now. Like, I know you got to go to an E3 that was like a start, because E3, like, Stadia did their little announcement before with Destiny, and then you got to see XCloud. Like, this is kind of like the very beginning of like the next phase of a lot of stuff. Like, XCloud, the remote play, and all those things are all coming in different ways. And this is like the first piece, and Bungie is like, yes, let's do that. And I think it's really cool that we actually get to see them at the right time that they're free, that they can talk about it the way they want to. Because if they were like behind Activision, they'd be like, they wouldn't be able to like say, they wouldn't be able to say half the stuff that they want to. And now they're just like, play anywhere, no exclusives and all that stuff. And they're just going to be like, we want to do cross play, but we got cross. Just the fact that they've said the words cross play in interviews, the fact that it's a want is awesome, because you know they want to. It's just the infrastructure, whether they wait for the new consoles, like, what is it going to take to get there? Is it a D3 and stuff like that? So. Damn.
Took 12 hours for the damn cross-save foundational. Who could imagine, you know, what it would take for, you know, cross-play completely. I agree.
It should have a fairly healthy player base, because they made that deal. Like, you get, you know, if you sign up early, you get all of Destiny Forsaken with Stadia for free, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's the one thing that's really going to help it, too.
The new light. Like, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
New light. That's the thing, actually. Like, new huge. Light is going to be huge for the player, but just everywhere.
Then I will bring those blueberries into comp. Yes, let's go.
I was like, cool guys, KD is already pretty high, but as soon as it's like, all right, September 18th, man, Mike, just KD is just climbing. I don't know why. I can only imagine how many people you are going to be making feel real bad about trying to play against you. So, but hey, at that point, you know, like September 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, if you get more of those, like, improve your KD videos up, you're going to be just exploding, sir.
Mm-hmm. It's something to think about, man. I've thought about it, trying to get a game plan going into it.
I know. I've been like, okay, so you're new to Destiny. Like, I know I've got to make, like, a couple of those. Like, you're new to Destiny series. Like, what to think about. Don't be an idiot in public events. Please don't shoot this guy. Like, there's some stuff, like, the average person who has no clue what's going on could probably use to see.
That wizard, he came from the moon, things like
oh
that.
Oh, my God.
That, you're really good. That's one thing I like about you. Like, you don't shame the new guy.
No, like, that's been me for the longest time is...
Yeah.
Like, I've been making content for solo players, because that's like, played for a long time. Some of my friends would be around or wouldn't for a little while, but it's like, it was the point where I was like, I wanted to challenge myself to see if I could solo Nightfall, and especially with Extinguish, it sucked. Like, there were many a deaths and many a redos. But then it finally got to that point. It was like, okay, I can do this. Now let me see if I can make it to where I could help other people do it. And that was the goal for a while. And then it's the live commentary and stuff like that. I can't tell you how many times I've repeated the phrases that I've said in my recordings, like take 10. I'm like saying all this stuff over and over, but it's like, when it finally does come together, well, people do appreciate it. And that's the same thing for you. Cool. It's like, I can tell the time you put into yours. It's very, very obvious, and just hats off to what you do as well. Cause yours is the detail, the time. It's like, and that's one of those, like, cause honestly watching yours, not trying to steal yours, but just the way you do your videos is making me like, I wonder if I truly did just spend like 3 or 4 days with a gun or a piece of armor and just like, okay, this is my thoughts on it, or like, this is how you can use it. And that's the way you spend days with something. It's not just like, hey, I got it. Here's my first play gameplay. Cool, go. You're like, no, I want to know the ins and outs, the workings and those types of things. And those are the ones I think that people feel like, hey, you know, videos can be like 2 minutes. You're like, oh, or I can do a 15-minute video about Demolitionist that turns into a video about a perk. And then all of a sudden you're like, hey, I have a whole different video I didn't expect to have. So,
yeah. So, I mean, what's so cool about, here's my personal deal, man. Like, everyone has been so, in my experience, very supportive, man. Like, I talked to Rick Hackus and Bife and Mesa Sean, like,
salute.
All of those, yeah.
And they help me, right? And I help them when I can. Like, everyone is pulling for each other. And what's so cool about the Destiny content creation community is, like, there's literally a place for everyone. Whether it be, you know, a funny video or, like, an on-the-surface, like, I'm going to show you the gun video or, like, a hot take video. Like, it's all there. Mm. I'm like, well, you know, I've tried doing kind of an on the surface video when I get something like, okay, this is it. I'm showing it to you guys. This is what it does. But like, get it and go into like Kepri Sting is a good example, man. Like everybody hates Kepri Sting. I'm like, well, let's look at Kepri Sting. So I made like a 14 minute video on it. You know, trying to announce how to use it, how to find success with it, things like that. I don't know. That's just I love doing it. I love getting into weapons. Like I said, I've shot every weapon in the game. It's my jam, right? It's more so for me and for them, I guess.
No doubt.
It's good stuff.
Hush.
Oh yeah, tell me about Hush. I haven't got that yet. I've been slowly working on it.
Like, it's an extremely skillful weapon, but I was messing with it, dude. Like, again, I'm on console. Like, it hits shots at over 120 meters. Like, it's hitting full damage. The accuracy on it's like it's essentially over 100 because of opening shot. Like, the hitbox is like you could aim at their chest. It's a headshot. It's an amazing bow. So, like, what I'm going to talk about in this review is like, even if you don't get the main perk going, and the main perk is lethal, like, it's still like one of the best bows in the game, period. Hands down. Like, you have to hip fire it, right? And that's tough on consoles. Like, I'm kind of working through it. So, like, at 34 and a half meters, your aim assist just completely stops. Like, on console, and I'm really excited to kind of show my findings with it. Like, it's 34 and a half meters, which is coincidentally the same exact effective range of an Awestringer. But when you get that perk going, you have a lot of fun. It's like, honestly, for me, it's one of the most fun I've had in Destiny in a long time, dude. Like, it's such a fun weapon. And it holds its own in PvE as well. Like, I did the entire Crown of Sorrow raid with it. Like, it's fun.
Wait, really? Damn.
I did.
This is impressive. It's that cool guy stuff. Weapon that I laugh at. I'm like, I'm not that. And then he's over here breaking it down, showing how effective it is. And I'm like, all right, damn it. I got to go just put it through the paces because cool guy said... this is literally vintage cool guy.
Yeah, this is exactly it.
So, like, I laughed at that weapon when it was announced. Like, I was just like, what is this? Why am I gonna hit fire with this? Then here we go. Some practical
and console specifically, right? So, like, everything matters, like enhanced bow targeting and bow targeting, like that helps the aim assist. Like, you need all that for this thing to work well. Gotcha. And the PC guys from like 40-50 meters can just hit people in the head from hip fire. Like, you can't do that on console. Like, you have too many factors. You have thumbs, right? It's hard to do.
You have
like
thumbs. You have
to completely different than a PC player. So, like, I'm excited to get into that. But it's a very high skill gap weapon, dude. And when you're jamming with it, like, you're rocking and shaking. Like, I love it. But
nice.
Yeah,
you put that out there. You put it in.
So I guess the other question, since we're talking about pinnacles at this point, what are your thoughts on now the path to get Revoker and also like Revoker's, like Revoker itself, like the perk, just like, I don't know, the best way to say it is not rewarding skilled play. Kind of as you said, like Hush is a skilled weapon and somebody who actually puts the time in is good with a bow is good with it. Now you've got Revoker as a sniper and it's not bad, but it's like you're rewarding misses more than you are rewarding like skilled shots with a sniper, which is something everybody wanted, something to be good. So what do you think about that?
I'm still working on it, but I know all about it and I've seen it. Like, here's the deal with Revoker and that entire quest line. That's the best thing that they could have done for comp.
Yes, I will agree with the quest line. Yeah.
Yeah, because it gets players in there. They're always getting, you know, if they win a game, they're always getting progress. Like, that's the best thing that they could have done. They should have done that the entire time. Mm-hmm. It helps for a more healthy player population.
Yep. Right.
Revoker, it has the lowest zoom in the game. It's tied with Twilight Oath and, there's one more. Guard one, Long Shadow maybe?
Mm-hmm.
With a certain scope. But it's got a very low scope. It's high impact. It's got the original OG ambush scope, which is like my favorite. Like, more than short gaze. I love it in Destiny 1.
Nice.
But I'm okay with the perk because I think the pinnacle weapons... Like, dude, Lunas Howl is game-breaking. Not Forgotten is game-breaking. And it was. And it went on for way too long. I mean, that's just my personal opinion, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was supposed
console,
to.
Right?
Oh my god! Everywhere, and it's funny now because people are still using them, but you can compete with them. Like, you can outshoot them a lot easier now. Before, it was just like you get deleted; you couldn't do anything about it. Like, if you're using an AR or Ace of Spades, you're done.
Done.
You know. It's supposed to get players in the playlist. And I'm telling you right now, like, Lunas Howl kept players out of comp. the weapon. The weapon's being used against them. They couldn't do anything about it. Right. So with Revoker, I'm okay because all it is a guaranteed mulligan, right? It's almost like a reverse icebreaker.
Yeah. Right.
Still, I mean, I don't have 100% accuracy, right?
No, definitely not me.
You're going to miss shots, right? So, I mean, so that tells me with that weapon, if you're going to miss, miss high, right?
Right.
Obviously, if somebody's low, I don't ever shame, and you shouldn't either, for bodying somebody with a sniper rifle, especially an aggressive frame, right? There so, like, go. I'm okay because it's not game-breaking, but it is pinnacle in the fact that if you're missing shots, you should miss them high, and you're going to have a lot of ammo. With that being said, though, I think Beloved's a lot better sniper rifle. Beloved, aim assist is off the charts for console. It has the right perks. Snapshot quick draw or with box breathing, it's one of three very special weapons in the game that can down a super office spawn with being Tatara Gaze, Izanagi's Burden, and now Beloved. It's like, that's a special thing. And then, of course, no distractions. That's a whole other story.
Oh, yeah.
Perk sets you can put together, I think, is going to be a better overall experience than having Revoker.
Gotcha. Fair enough.
Yeah. I mean,
it's. And in that aspect, it's kind of a shame.
Yeah, because you just, you're like, oh, here's this other PvE activity that, like, just puts that other one, you know, kind of puts it down a peg or two. So
now it is kinetic, but I'm fine with my Bite of the Fox with explosive rounds, like as an aggressive frame.
Nice. Those ones I get killed by the most. That Bite of the Fox and the other one.
Mm-hmm. So I'm apparently probably doing everything completely wrong with what I'm playing with lately. So I have a Persuader.
Nothing wrong with that.
But it's got the short zoom scope, so it's got the 50 val telescopic, but it's got snapshot sights, moving target, and I threw target adjuster on there. I've been having some fun with that one, actually. Like, just the snappiness of that scope, it's like the fastest one I've ever seen, at least. And I'm sure there are other ones like it, but just the in and out of that zoom is so, so quick. I've really enjoyed it. And that just shows my ignorance when it comes to a lot of sniper stuff. But I have been having fun with that one. But I've got my 50 precision kills. I think I'm 2 out of 300 for the kills, and then I got to go work my comp work. But I kind of want to work on at the lowest glory level possible, see if I can get a little more progress towards Mountaintop, because that's one that eludes me. And, man, that quest sucks. God.
Yeah.
Mountaintop is brutal.
Yeah, it's rough, man. It is rough. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, it has been interesting, though. Like, a lot of the pinnacle at, like, Mountaintop now used in a lot of raids. Recluse is used in a lot of PvE activities now.
Isn't that wild?
It's like, so those pinnacles are being pulled over and stuff. And even for a legendary hand cannon, like Not Forgotten and Lunas, was still pretty solid when it was better again PvE as well. So
speaking of which, they might have to give my boy Redrix a little love.
Redrix, Claymore, Redrix, Broadsword.
Man, come on, man. Need to do a little something with it. Like, I don't know. I mean, Desperado is cool and all, but it's just like, you know, it's just not in the meta, you know, that style of pulse, and I think it does need a little something, especially, you know, it's up there as a pinnacle weapon. It's a semi grind for it. It's not crazy. It's just now longevity, you know, kind of sticking with it. But I would like for them to do it, because it seems like every other one now is kind of finding, every other pinnacle weapon is kind of finding its place, in so to speak, except that one, in my opinion.
Well, I've been using my Go Figure for so long, so if another pulse rifle was good, I'm sure I'd find out. My Go Figure has like 40,000 kills on it or something.
Jesus.
Oh, there you go.
Well, it's Outlaw, Rampage, Appended Magazine, even that great, but it's got the Devil's, it's a long zoom scope. I got a Range Master work on it with counterbalance. So I just laser people from across the, I love that gun in PvP. Like, but give me a medium range, I'm screwed. I gotta play a little farther with that one, but I do love when I get set. I'll annoy snipers with that gun, which is what I love doing. So, but yeah, so we had Heroic Menagerie, Chest Glitch now, which is gonna, I know it had to happen. I know it's gonna have to happen. Just kind of a shame. We'd like to see some balance out of it. And then we have, finally, they're announcing a date for, the Grimoire Anthology 2. Did either of you guys get the first book, the Anthology 1?
I have.
It's so good. It's so nice. Like, the second one coming, too. So we've got, and I think they literally made this emote for, like, Bife and Mylan Games and a couple of them.
The Loremaster emote.
Just like, let me open my book. And then if you buy the emote, you did get a discount on the lore anthology. So that'll be pretty cool. So, Yeah, that one's just a small announcement, but definitely one that I could see those two just like that's like part of them now, the lore books and stuff. So got a little bit about the Bungie Foundation. So, of course, if you guys didn't see GuardianCon of where we're all going, Bungie did the 400K. Lupo with the over 900,000 on his block was just so crazy. He's going to be at GuardianCon as well. So at least shake his hand for what he did for St. Jude's, almost a million in 4.5 hours. But they're trying to raise a little bit more, so they've still got their goal for through the Bungie Foundation. They're trying to do iPads for Kids program that they're doing. So between now and July 14th, they're trying to raise $77,000 to get as that donation towards that program. And again, if you do want to contribute $50, you will get your System of Peace. It's another heart emblem. So that's one of those things I think is... I know they do it, and I know we follow the Bungie blogs a lot, but I don't see a lot, and I'm not saying other developers don't,
right?
But I was like, I don't see as many developers do like this much for their community, I guess. And it may be a piece of just where I'm not as close with developers, and I'm sure they do, but just like, I got a shout out to Bungie and like just the stuff, just all the work, like so much of the store, they don't even keep. Like, so much of the proceeds go to just like a good cause all the time. I forget too, like the details on that, but I don't know. That's one of the... Have you guys ever seen any other devs, like, do that type? I think there's so many things that Bungie does that, like, are understated that probably keep us fanboys attached to them even more.
Yeah.
They're very special, man. What's cool about Bungie is, like, you know... America was news. I was so upset when they left, dude, because, like, I've been following their careers for forever. It seems like forever I've been following those guys. And I don't know what happened. Maybe they just, I mean, whatever, that's between them. But, you know, I used to really enjoy, and that's another thing Bungie did, man. I love them, actually. When they used to go and take a team, like they would take the sound team and a Vidoc, and like they would go out in like the desert and get weird noises. I'm like, okay, this is how we made the Zen Meteor sound. Like, I think that that's so cool, and no one really does that. And we look at blogs like for, like Apex and Anthem. It's a general from BioWare. From, I mean, every now and then they'll bring in a dev, but they'll say, hey, you know, developer here. And they don't really specify what they do. Bungie's very in touch with their community, and they really value their devs. And you can see the passion when they talk in the Vidocs, dude. Yeah. Like when they're talking about their weapons and their work, like they're so passionate about it, man. And that's why I'm kind of happy that they're on their own ship, because it's like a party now. Like they're having a party right now.
Yeah, I feel the walls are coming down, and I think you nailed it. I mean, to your question, look, you know, I've been gaming a long time, you know, and just my experience. I know, yes, Destiny's one of my favorite games ever, but in my experience, I've never seen a development team. I've never seen that level of intimacy with the community and their level of interaction, and you know, for them to be going to GuardianCon and things like that. I mean, got a chance, you know, to meet Deej a few times, and it's just you feel it. You feel the energy, and that's one thing when you see like the St. Jude stuff and the Bungie Foundation stuff. You know, I don't see it, man. I don't see it for the guy. I'll see other shit. Yeah, here's patch notes for the week. You know, and you know they may have, you know, a dev once in a while, but like CG said, like watch a Vidoc, watch a ride along, right?
Watch Dave Samuels talk about anything.
Exactly. Like just, the thought process.
Protect him at all costs.
Absolutely. You know what I'm saying? Like, you just see that passion, man. And, you know, even, you know, people, shout out to a couple of lore people that left recently, but, you know, just even them talking about little things and nuances into why decisions were made. I love that stuff. And it's very rare in gaming, you know, in my opinion, that you get this level of intimacy with the dev.
Yeah. The Vidoc, those are always really cool when they take the second. When they showed the guy talking about the artifacts, he's like, man, this last tier, it's almost going to be like exotic perks. They're going to be like really, really powerful. Like, he's pumped about his thing that he's working on. It's just like, he's like, I am legit, dude, like, out of my chair, like, excited for you guys to get your hands on this.
Yes.
Like, bro, those types of things. Man,
when Forsaken dropped and they were debuting the subclass trees and they were talking about the new supers and how pumped it was. I was pumped.
Yeah. Cannot wait. And then you've got the finishing moves coming up.
Oh, I forgot about that.
That's still, I think I fell out of my chair almost when I was I was literally laughing out loud. I'm like, this is Mortal Kombat. We have finished it. We're punching ogres and they're back flipping off. I like, dude, like what is
it's the ragdoll effect too on the ogres. It's like the greatest thing ever.
Oh my God. Oh like my God. That is one of those things. I'm like, how do you, for one, that's one of those things that proves the community has no idea what they need. Bungie will like figure it out sometimes because we would know what he would have ever thought of that. And all of a sudden, like, I'm going to go punch an ogre in the face and he's going to go flying off the moon. Like, what?
Dude, it's crazy.
That type of stuff looks so much fun.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
They should bring back Omnigold just so you can do a finishing move on her.
She looks like, she actually looks like she's in there. She's a very unique looking wizard. And she is one of those, like, you see Crota, you see Fogoth. I would bet money that Omnigul or an Omnigul Phantasm or whatever it's just called, she's in there. I would probably bet. Because I stared at her damn face too much in...
Yeah.
What she's getting an uppercut for me, dude.
Like, oh my God, I cannot wait. Her scream still haunts my nightmares when I look at that strike.
Yes, screams. Oh, like, man.
Whoever did that...
Yeah, drop the craft.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, man.
I was just saying that scream is terrifying.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I just like when Crota used to, I mean, what you call that Crota? Eris used to say her name. You know what I'm saying? But at the beginning of the mission or strike or whatever, it's Omnigul. Like, it used to get me hype. Like, I like the fact that Eris is back. That, you know, the actress that played.
Morla Gorondona. Yeah, she's one that like I've seen her on a couple podcasts. Like, she always seems really, really cool. I think she's gonna be at GuardianCon too.
And I can't wait to meet her, man.
I know. Really? Yep. Yeah, she's gonna be there. So go look up her Twitter. Make sure you know what she looks like. So shake her hand for bringing.
Dope.
Like, her and Cade are part of one of my favorite lines in all of Destiny is
which one?
Get your rock off my map. I love that line from Cade. And like, and just those two are about as perfect for like counter of each other that you could possibly have. And they're so good. And we lost one, but it's been a while but we're getting Aris back. So
quick question for Google, lore question. So, being that he just talked about our faded friend, you know, we lost our guy. So is this the Aldrin returned? do we get him at the table? Do we get him in the tower? What do you think?
I sure hope so.
Because
Datto was talking about it in that reveal for Shadowkeep. Like, I think it's on the plate, dude. Like, I think it's on the plate at some point. It's almost impossible, but maybe Cade can somehow make a return.
Cade 7.
There you go. Colonel 2.0. Like,
oh man. So, that's most of what we've got for the TWAB. I know they've got some known issues and stuff like that. There's some cool videos of the week. Definitely check those out. But yeah, Guardian Con is the piece coming. So if you guys are going to Guardian Con, obviously all of us are going to be there. But I got a couple general questions. Of always like to get other opinions when we have you guys on here. So for you, cool guy, just kind of a curiosity and a thought. And this has been kind of in flux as of lately for a lot of people too. So we've got Shadowkeep. We've got supposedly four other seasons. Kind of first piece is, do you think for the next season pass and stuff like that, do you think it's going to keep to a 3-week cadence or 3-month cadence? Do you think they're going to have a little more spacing in there? What do you picture for like the next season pass of content? Do you see it just like truly a calendar year? Do you think if they need the freedom, they'll take it? Like, what do you expect for Shadowkeep's like cadence of releases and just kind of what to look for in the upcoming year? And then I'll get to the even bigger one.
I think that this next pass is going to be strikingly similar to this one. It's going to have a big expansion, excuse me, like Forsaken, right? Shadowkeep. And they're going to add on to it. And I think that because it's all on their own, it's right there in the studio. So I think that's a perfect chance to gauge what they can handle. I think that once they figure out what they can handle, that's the move to add more or less. But I think it's going to be good. And what's cool, like I said, is they're away. They're very open now. Like I said, you've been seeing Luke talk. You've seen a whole bunch of people talk. Like, because they can now, it seems, right? Capital R reasons.
Yeah.
I think, honestly, if the players want it, they're going to try it. You know, some way, shape, or form. They can't guarantee it, but they're at least look into it. So be similar to this pass after the first you know, year, I guess. But the following one, I think that there's going to be some changes. Now,
okay,
meeting more, hopefully. It could be about the same, but I think that, that they need to judge as a studio what they can handle.
That's fair. So then the other question is, and this is one that we've had a lot of talks about this, but it's also like we've had some changes in like understanding as we get more knowledge about Bungie. And as they say, like, hey, we put the contest modifier in there. We've just had some devs kind of do a bit of a crunch. And instead of doing Lord of Wolves now, we're going to give our, you know, devs some time to like be humans and not put them through crunch and stuff like that. So the idea is if they keep on this cadence, or even as you said, maybe spacing more or less or whatever's in the future, where do you picture, or do you even want a Destiny 3? That's kind of like, I know it's two-parted. Like, do you even want it? Do you want an evolution of Destiny 2? Or is there things that you think only a D3 can do? So trying to get your breakdown on that whole big giant question mark that Datto tried to ask and obviously can't get an answer to either. So.
I personally believe that there will be a Destiny 3. And I only say that because the next generation, right? This it was very held back on consoles.
Mm-hmm.
With loading times and like, so imagine the freedom that they're gonna have with the current, like, Destiny's a huge game. They always talk about mm-hmm. patch notes, like, well, why does it take so long to patch things? Like, Fortnite's just one big map and they're quote in beta, right? It's still a beta, guys. Maybe the real version's gonna come out, but
maybe
good that point. Means that they can push patches out like it's mm-hmm. no problem, right? Because but every time they do that, they have to pay to get these patches to go along. Now they can hotfix on their side, but mm-hmm. the actual patches to fix stuff costs money, and it they have to do them all at once, essentially. Like, they do big patches when the seasons come out. You have to think, as big as Destiny is right now, imagine with, you know, a 0.8 second loading screen going from the moon to the Mars.
Mm-hmm.
And then being at 60 frames, like it's almost like that's mm-hmm. the end goal, and I think that they want to get to an end goal for Destiny.
I agree.
Maybe the final version, they might just call it Destiny, or maybe Destiny 3, and have it as they want it to be, and just an MMO, kind of like World of Warcraft, right? Like, that would be, to me, the perfect, like, way we're going to end it and keep going, right? Just mm-hmm. that type of mentality. But I do hope, and I believe that there will be a Destiny 3.
Okay.
That's so, just me, though.
Okay, so it's like, so you want a D3, so here's the other question is, when? When do you see it falling in, like, if it's, like, certain years? Because if we're talking, like, we've got now content with Shadowkeep and potential year through basically August of 2020, roughly, obviously all guesses, but where do you picture D3 falling for their development cycle? And then also, as you said, with the new consoles, where do you think it fits best?
Well, a lot of us follow it, man, because I remember they had that $100 million mobile game deal, right? So I don't even know what's going on with that. So, like, there's development team working on that. And while they had Activision, like, they were making Shadowkeep, they were making the Gambit stuff. Like, there's stuff that has Destiny's blueprint all over it. Like, but mm-hmm. not there. It's just kind of tough. Like, do they have teams working on Destiny 3 right now? Like, no one knows, right? Mm-hmm. There's no way to know. Right. So if they are, then I would expect it probably like in 3 years.
Interesting.
Okay. 2.5, 3 years.
Okay.
2022-ish.
2022-ish. So you think they start off the next console generation still remaining in D2?
I do.
Okay. Fair enough.
Thank
you. Interesting.
Yeah. We've had our speculations of what were you were saying. Were you thinking launch of consoles, or where were you at?
Right after.
And D3 is right after?
I think D3 is probably, if I'm going to guess, again, no pride now, this is just me guessing. Consoles are going to come in, what, 2020? Fall of 2020. I'm saying 2021, I think they might be ready in the fall. Stick with their September cadence. And that's what I'm going with. Because it'll be a full year of them kind of adjusted to the new consoles, and they've kind of cross generation D1 before, so that again, just speculation, you know. I think they're ready to go. I know for a fact, you know, these guys are working on it, Luke Smith and Noseworthy, even Datto kind of hinted at it in the recent VODOC, and they said, well, we're not ready to talk about it at this time, you know, marketing speak, but you know, so it's being worked on. There's no doubt about it. You know, it's just a matter of the timing, and you know, we'll see what happens. I know this.
I'm hyped just thinking about it, dude. Like,
yeah, I mean, everything you said. I mean, just think about it. At that point, next generation would have settled in. You know, you got those beasts, the Zens, and you know, the Navis, and then you got, you know, SSDs on consoles. These are huge things, you know. And then the ultimate vision of crossplay. I still think that is where they ultimately want to be. And cross save is going to definitely rise the base up from Shadowkeep on. But once you're talking about crossplay, now granted, you know, PC and console, they might have to separate them, or it may be optional.
Filter your keyboard and mouse list, you know, and stuff.
Like how sweaty it is, maybe a sweaty button. Do you want to engage in this sort of activity with PC community?
You're going to open the M&K floodgates?
Exactly. Exactly. But yeah, I mean, I think that is the goal, man. And once they do that, Destiny's gonna be hard to beat, because now you're talking cross save and cross play, man. I don't know what a lot of looter shooters are gonna be able to do with that. That is huge.
Well, Borderlands is gonna get a lot of play when it comes out. Again, they're right around the same time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Why it's so smart on Bungie's part to be like, you know what, you buy this season pass if you want this season. Mm-hmm. That way players can come back. Like, say a new raid comes out. Very smart on their part.
Yes. Yep. New Light?
New Light is going to be probably one of the biggest things for, I think, PC, because the Steam population is ginormous. There's so many mm-hmm. people to play games on Steam. But most, like, your free games of a decent level are so few and far between. I mean, you've got Dauntless that is, you know, like Monster Hunter 0.8. Like, it's not quite there. Mm-hmm. And then you've got Fortnite that's free, and you've got some other, but like, bigger free multiplayer. You put Destiny where they can go roam planets, play the campaign, play mm-hmm. PvP, Gambit. Like, Gambit's part of Forsaken, and Gambit's just going to be part of this. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if Gambit Prime's going to be there. That'll be kind of interesting. But, I mean, just the fact that they can go in and do all of those things and then be like, mm-hmm. it's free. That alone will help the population. It's, Random microtransactions and stuff like that is going to be just so crazy.
It's literally a free test drive, and you know, after a while, you know, new Guardians come in, they start playing with you, start playing with your friend. So you know what, all right, I'll plunk down on Forsaken now, just, you know, after messing around and seeing what you guys are doing. I'm really liking that Destiny's in a good place. I think this is huge, man. This new model, this new Light model, is because they're not restricting as much as I thought they would. I thought they would really be more restrictive. It's not as bad. And like, you know, CoolGuy said, like, hey, if you don't like, you know, a certain specific DLC or any part of the annual pass, you're like, skip this one. You get the one you want, like a la carte. Like, it's kind of crazy, man.
Yeah, it'll be like just buying the Black Armory Forges but skipping out on Gambit Prime or something like that, which is probably what that's
it's a great
sadly
model.
What a lot of people probably would have done for that one. But I know, like me, it's like, I know, because if you buy the whole pack, it's like 35 for Shadowkeep and 25 more, and I'm like, that's like, you know, 2.5 seasons. That's like, that's easy purchase for me to justify, because I'll get them all. But somebody's just like, hey, I just get the expansion, Shadowkeep's a standalone. Cool, I can play like the next season of Opulence, because that's the really cool one. And I don't know, I think it's going to be kind of crazy. So that's definitely something to look forward to as well.
Yeah, man.
I'm trying to think of anything else we've got. This actually kind of went fairly quickly.
Yeah.
Nice light one. We were talking about the gunplay earlier, right? And what's so cool about this new model is, like, this is a free-to-play game, and they're pretty much saying, we stand by our product. You play our game, I think you're going to like it.
Facts. Mm-hmm. Facts. Once you get hooked in, man, like you said, once you get hooked in with that gunplay, and again, playing with your friends, no restrictions, no, you know, oh, this exotic is only here, and, you know, say, oh, this map is only here. Remember all that stuff, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Just finally to bed with it, and there's people on Twitter who I know are like, not, they are Destiny haters. When that announcement got made for Shadowkeep, I seen a bunch of screenshots installing Destiny 2. it's going to bring some people back. It's definitely, and like I said, I think the player population is reflective of that right now, that it went back up to 1 million, because people are excited. you know. And shout out to Teacup Rizzo. He's going at it. He said, I don't think it would be fair to be as far as the cross play. I see your point. I think the only thing I'm saying as far as cross play, yes. I think consoles, definitely. You know what I'm saying? You know, PlayStation, Xbox, that kind of thing. PC is either going to be separate or optional. They may keep it separate. But there's no doubt in my mind that cross play will come in some form, you know, by D3.
Yeah, and I think I don't know if it's Fortnite or something. Basically, you have the option of, like, if you're playing crossplay on mouse and keyboard or on console and controller, I think you have the option to pair up with people on, like, PC and mouse and keyboard. It's something like, I don't know which game specifically, but that's a way to.
Modern Warfare is doing that too. It's just strict input based. Like, you'll play other controllers, and so PC would probably be with Stadia.
Yeah, I completely see that.
Yep. So I mean that. I don't know. There's so much to look forward to in the fall, and it's not that far away. We're talking,
I know.
We're almost in July now, and then it's like literally just July and August. And then we were talking Cool Guy last week. So I know we obviously play a butt ton of Destiny, technical measurement, by the way, of course. but what are you looking forward to, any other games in the fall? Because we all know September is absolute bananas when I listed it off last time. Like, is there anything that is going to be like straining on your time taken away from Destiny, because September alone is packed, much less anything else going on. So what else are you looking forward to, or what else are you actually playing? Because just to get a little more background.
I tell you what, man, I play a lot of Destiny.
I mean, when you spend 4 days with Hush, there's not a lot of time for anything else. So,
my wife and I's Xbox is we have a cool little gaming set. We game together. So Xbox is mine. So basically, the content just shares, right? So on my Xbox, I have Anthem, I have Red Dead, I have Kingdom Hearts, and a couple others. I never even touched them.
Yep.
Right? They're installed, ready to go.
Yep.
I do see myself playing Borderlands because I love Gearbox, man. Certain developers, I love Treyarch, I love Bethesda, I love Gearbox, I love Bungie, right? Mm-hmm. I give those games a chance, and I will be playing Borderlands 3.
Yeah.
The only game I play right now is Apex Legends, and it's perfect because...
In and out.
You know, it's a free-to-play game. It's a battle royale. I just jump in with a couple friends, play a couple games, and then back onto Destiny. Mm-hmm. It's the only one I really see. And I'm going to play Cyberpunk. Cyberpunk can be, a generational game, dude. From everything that people are saying.
Boy, you have no idea, CG. Mm-mm-mm. I got a chance to see that bad boy behind the scenes.
Did you?
Oh, yeah. I have check the video out on our Iron Lords podcast YouTube channel. Bro, let me tell you right now, that I know it's the foundation. We still got some time, but what they've shown so far is so mind blowing to me. It feels like they got one. If you're a fan of Mass Effect and impactful choices, and as far as just the world itself, a living, breathing world, it looks phenomenal. I cannot wait for Cyberpunk. So excited about that.
Yeah, that one's going to be big. My brother will never shut up about Witcher 3, and justify it. But it's what they did for a game with so much content and story. I mean, he said the combat could use some love and stuff like that. Yeah. And that'll be the interesting thing is they're going first person shooter on this, right?
Yeah, they got it. They got to tighten up the impact of I feel of the gunplay. I feel that's, if I had to nitpick, that was the only thing I just said, at the end of the session, you're allowed to give feedback. And part of my feedback was just look, everything else, you really need to listen to me. You guys got a great game. I think the only thing they need to work on is I felt like because this is now the Bungie in me, Destiny in me.
You're spoiled, dude.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like, all right, the bullets need to pop, the guns need to pop a little bit more. And the reactions when people get shot, I need to feel that. I feel like they were kind of spongy, a little bit Division 1-y.
Potato sack.
Yeah, I need, that reaction. If they get that visceral nature in it, there's no touching it. So they still got time, That's what I think a lot of other people who got the chance to see it in media, that we got a chance to see it behind closed doors. That was the only consensus, little negative that we can nitpick. But other than that, I mean, again, game is phenomenal. Just the different ways you can attack a same scenario, stealthy, personality-wise, you know, tech wise. I mean, it's like three games in one, like one scenario played out so many ways, in a Mass Effect way, in a stealthy kind of what you call Assassin's Creed way, in a Watch Dogs way, just based on your class and how you completely customize, is phenomenal.
I'm stoked.
Yeah, that one's going to be crazy. So I know my brother will be playing that. I think that's one of those I'll actually have to step away from. But yeah, it's like there's so many. I'm like you, cool guy, because I've like, oh, I got partway through Horizon, then I went back to Destiny. And then God of War was probably the one that I actually stepped away and I made it all the way through. I think I didn't kill one Valkyrie, but I basically finished the whole game. And that's one of the first times in a while I've truly finished one. Like Breath of the Wild. I'm like, I'm at some weird early point in that game because I got it, but again, it was always me coming back to Destiny, and it's like, it's an issue. That was like, even yesterday, I didn't get to do what I wanted to do because I had work, and then I had to run up to work in the middle of my day. So it's like the 12 hours that Destiny was off when I was like, hey, I could knock out a game like Inside, or I could like reboot Breath of the Wild. And I'm like, and Destiny's back on. I'm like, guess what I'm going to go do? So I kind of wanted to ask you, and I know it's kind of one thing that I've seen quite a few people, like Grenader Jake, I saw him put out his post where he's like taking a break from streaming and stuff like that. Do you ever... Or, I mean, have you experienced or at least can empathize with some people talk about like burnout, or you see people kind of having the work-life balance of doing YouTube. For you, are there certain aspects that you've seen? Are there times you've thought about taking a break? Are you kind of at a good point where you have found a good balance for it? And then if you have, what's your trick?
No, so like for me, it's how I approach weapons. I look into weapons, do like I said, I really enjoy getting new roles, everything they have to offer. And then, you know, I'll get another role. So that's why it doesn't get boring for me, right? The PvP aspect, I mean, it's a different time every single time you play it, right? If I was one of those guys that went into a six stack and used Not Forgotten, Dust Rock, I would probably be really burnout, right? I'm using Trinity Ghoul against those guys, you know? So,
you and your bows, man, you're scary.
Even his bows, man, yeah.
Trinity Ghoul, I think, is going to get a... draw time catalyst, and it's going to be really good.
It needs something. It needs a little bit of something.
Yeah.
If you draw, it's too slow. Yeah. But no, so it's always refreshing for me. That, and so like opulence is because my wife came back to play, right? So she's still so and she's a casual Destiny player. She loves the PvP, but she really enjoyed the Menagerie. So that, to me, that's like, well, Bungie did a good job. My wife likes it, right?
I mean, that's, hey, that's a fair bar. Absolutely. So,
yeah, that's a good assessment.
And I mean, with the community, man, like I'm doing raids. I'm doing just, there's a whole bunch, there's always something to do in Destiny, right? That's what's so great about Destiny. So,
yep.
Can it and have a good time with it. So,
completely agree, man. Sounds like you've got a nice balance where you're not just like absolutely burning out, like, do you have like a day job and stuff, and this is more on the side, or is this your full-time gig?
So I am a radiologic technologist, and I did that for about 3-4 years, and then probably 7 months ago, I quit that job to do YouTube because it got to a point to where I wanted to do more or be a little bit more in depth with my content, right? And like I said, I kind of do my own thing on YouTube, right? I just find something that I like and I want to talk about it. And there's certain things that, I mean, like that Scout rifle from Gambit, like I'll review it and like, I'm like, it's not good, right? So I won't hype it. I won't hype it if it doesn't need to be hyped, right? But I do know that there's a lot of, like, time ago, like when Warmind came out, we still had static rolls. There was the foregone conclusion. It was a high impact AR. Like I did a full 4-minute video on that. And I was like, why are you reviewing the foregone conclusion? I'm like, here's the deal. And like, my wife's a perfect example, right? The foregone conclusion is like their gun. Like, they get it. They love it. There are people that like guns that aren't technically good, but like, that's
their baby.
Their baby, right? So like, well, let's at least talk about it and why it's good and why you probably like it, but there's why the issues that it has, right? So I always do kind of off the wall things when I can. To a schedule, I try to do at least now 3-4 videos a week, but it's just getting the gameplay, and then of course the production of all of it, it just takes so long.
Well, I can only imagine your editing timeline is rather meticulous as well. So
I live for it, though. I love those timelines.
It is you're running so you said two monitors. You got what, like you got an ultra wide in there for your editing, or just like two pretty sizable ones?
pretty sizable. I use Asus. I love Asus's monitor. So
I'm staring at two of them right now. So I'm with you. Yeah, Asus. Yeah, 27 inch. That's mine. Oh man, yeah, we could definitely do a whole tech podcast, I think, on the side of it, because I sit here and look through. So okay, so what is your current? Because you said, what is your computer right now you're running on? I'm surely curious, because you said some of the videos. I know you started and they were really slow, but what are you currently running right now for your, since it's a little more full time gig, since you got to get production a little quicker than 7 hours.
All I do with my computer is edit, and it does what I need it to do. It's an i7. Actual specs on it. Mm-hmm. And you'd be proud of me. I literally know nothing. Like I said, we talked about Mist and Oregon Trail earlier. Like, I don't really know that much about computers. I installed my own RAM last month, and it worked.
Nice. Congratulations. There you go.
Salute this man.
Don't feel too bad. I had to give Cognito a little hard time. He was like, he sent me a picture and be like, so what are these? And I'm just sitting here going, those are the RAM. But I was like, I know you know it, but you're like, why is it all glowy? He's like, is this the right? And I'm like, yeah. Like,
I haven't built a rig. Like, I'm owed, for the record. So it's been like over plus 10, you know what I'm saying, years that I've even built a rig. So it's like, I'm so antiquated. So I'm like, damn, this thing's all glowing up now. And like, where you put the damn NVMe SSD at? Like, like, I'm just trying to feel my way around. So I'm like, here's my board. Where do I stick this thing? I need some more space for these games.
Check my specs here. Like, that's how bad I am.
Oh, you're good.
My graphics card, like, they don't make it anymore. It's an NVIDIA, like, 720 or something. Like, it can't run Destiny. That's all I know.
I was like, my computer sitting, my good one's over here. My other one's on my left, sitting on the floor still. And that's my 760 sitting on the floor. And that was... I knew as soon as I started playing, and then I tried to hit the record button on PC capture, and it just shut, like, basically stopped working. I was like, nope, can't do this on the same rig. So, I had, my investment was my rig over on my right. So that's, I can record and play and stream all in the same box, which is
nice.
Yeah, that's.
If I wanted to, like, I've thought about maybe like doing streams to maybe raise one for rig, and like, because like Cammy Cakes, and you guys know Cammy, right? Like,
yeah.
And like every day for a year and a half, I played with Cammy, right? Yep. We were two peas, but then he went to the dark side, right?
You mean the master race?
He left. tell him he left you behind.
To this, you know, the lowest population of the game, but anyway,
talk that talk. Oh, I like cool guys, so cool. He about that console life, I like it.
Dude, you know, I'll help you, Drewski will help you. We get people, you know, to get you a stream goal that way. Uh-huh. Play PC. But I don't know, man, like, played Destiny at 60 frames one time, that was GuardianCon when Gaming came, and like, I'll never forget it. Like, it felt so good. I'm like, this is what Destiny should feel like.
Yeah, this is where the eyes have been opened.
Yeah. CG, I'm with you, bro. I purposely chose to stay ignorant because I knew what would happen. Yeah. I knew playing it any level of it's over. And that's what happened. They literally went free to play. What was it, last November? Didn't they do that?
Yeah, something like that on Battle.
Yeah, like last November, it was like right around Black Friday. And then Ebontis hits me up. He's like, no excuse now. Free, buddy. He's like, hey, I had to get a rig because I was like, again, I'm running with a 10-year-old potato and, you know, trying to do podcasts and doing stuff. So I needed a rig just to step up my podcast game and start to, you know, to grow the channel. And I'm like, all right, he's right. I got to do it. So I'm like, all right, spec me out something. Just, you know, only thing I'm willing to go crazy is CPU and be reasonable with every other thing. So he you know, he had kid gloves with me. He's fighting me a little. He's like, no, you're going to have to. That's it. You're going to have to do that. I'm like, all right. So we made some compromises, and I got it. But I'm telling you right now, CG.
It's the way.
it is so night and day. Just the field of view alone, just altering that. It's just like, it's just the way it's supposed to be played. It's buttery smooth. It's amazing. And then now with cross save, it's like, okay, you know, if I want to play with my guys, I can easily do that, you know, in September. And that's the only thing that hurt the most was just like, you know, the majority of your friends and stuff like that. You got to make new friends, you know what I'm saying? And luckily I got E, shout out to Wilhelm Scream, shout out to Pyro, you know, those guys. They're very helpful. Very helpful. And, you know, once you find yourself a little crew that at least you got a couple people to do activity with, but for the most part, man, you'll be soloing and rocking out and having fun in your own little glorious world.
Yeah, I do need to get it at some point, man. I've always thought about it. I'd probably play with controller, and apparently,
you see me out here, controller gang, and I'm on top of it sometimes. He's elite controller. You're good to go, man. And with Game Boy, just press my button, record. You got all my options. Love it. Yeah, man. I would say September. If you're going to do it, CG, do it September.
Yeah, it's like you got so this way, coming. Yep.
So it's not a clean break. Yeah, you still have that association. You can go back and forth.
Well, I will probably get with you guys to help me out putting something together.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. No, that's one of those, like, for me that I live for. Like, I love building computers, and I only get to do it every, like, 4 or 5 years. I don't get to do it that often. So when I get to build one or somebody else wants to build one, I was like, I'll help. Mm-hmm. Please, can help? Mm-hmm. I'll build it for you. Just let me build the parts. Like, I would literally build it and ship it to somebody, like, if somebody would let. So, like, I don't know. It's just one of those things, like, putting all the pieces together. And that's my, like, ultra nerdy moment is, like, building computers, but I have an absolute blast doing it. So
he's I've had really a
couple. I have a couple people on Twitter that have been like, hey, what? I was like, well, what's your budget? What do you want? Okay, here's what I can try and build. And honestly, with like AMD coming out with this stuff in literally like a week or two, they're going to definitely put some game changers out there for, if nothing else, just to give Intel some competition. So now things are getting to a point where it's good for both sides. So it's like NVIDIA still got the graphics cards that you'd want, but like CPUs and competition, it's all good things going right now. So It's a good time to be a tech nerd and have fun and enjoy all the Stadia, build a computer, have cross-save, and use your controller, because apparently mouse and keyboard just isn't your thing. That's not really fine.
It's tough for us console guys, bro. It's tough, man.
I've always wondered how I would deal with it, because I've never tried. I mean,
honestly,
maybe I'll
like, it's like you. It takes some time to get used to. Like, I've been doing it off and on for, I've been playing, like, Rainbow Six with, like, an old-ass computer over dial-up. Like, I played that with a buddy of mine, like, so I've been using them both for so long, I feel like it's just kind of, I'm mediocre at both, because people can whoop, you know, mop the floor with me on PC probably all day long, and I'm sure you'll beat the crap out of me with a controller on PC, too, so you can just kind of laugh at me and be like, how's that mouse and keyboard treating you? Well, you're dead. That's going to be fine.
Is there any lag on PC?
Not much, man. That's one of the other things, too, is I'll be kind of curious when, that's one of the other things, I guess, when we talk about D3 that we didn't even get to, is, like, dedicated servers. That's the one I know everybody, like, for you, for console, for PC, like, Jesus. Whatever it is, like, there are, and I know my skill level, not in the top, not in the bottom of the barrel, I'm somewhere kind of in the okay range, but I know there are games I will jump into, and it is that point where it's like, and cool guy, if you can, you know, comment on this too, like, you're probably good most of the time, but there are times when, like, I'm hitting so many of my shots, and it's like, I feel like somebody on my team's probably the host, and I'm doing better, and then sometimes it'll flip, and then I'm like, I can't hit the broadside of a wall or something. Like, there are moments where that flip happens, and I think dedicated servers is one of the major ones, and that's one of those where I wonder, like, the Stadia population, if you're playing on Stadia, there is no way to host it. You're on there. Mm-hmm. They're hosting it. So that's, I think, one of the big questions for Stadia that'll be, do you feel... I mean, your skill level is probably so high, you probably don't. But do you have those feelings of where you, like, you know somebody on your team's hosting or you're hosting it out? Do you get those, like, dynamics of games where it feels good and feels like trash?
I do. Okay. So peer-to-peer matchmaking is just so... It's in the past, dude. Mm. Like, because how it works, because, like, people are like, well, you know, this game's lagging. You know, I have, you know, Google Fiber, and people just get upset. Like, it doesn't really matter what your internet is, because someone else, right? So it goes even further with skill-based matchmaking. Like, so when I used to play Destiny, I was top 400, top 300, top 100, whatever, top 100 in Rumble. So I'd play guys from like high, right? So you start doing peer-to-peer that's skill-based, it's starting to connect your skill, like, with people across the ocean, and having lag. I'm like, and I'm trying to kill the guy. I'm like, well, this is the last guy. Like, this is the guy that has, like, AOL dial-up internet cards. Like, he, like, saved all of them for this day to be in my game, right?
Yeah. You get your 250 hours free on your CD.
Yeah, that's, oh my god.
We all just dated ourselves, by the way, big time.
Yeah, we all dated ourselves.
Hardcore.
Hey, bro, I had the Sega channel, okay?
All right, woo, talk about it. Nice.
Which was mesmerizing as a kid. I'm like, how does that even work? But no, we're
no, good old like, online play.
I'm all about the game running properly, dude. So like when there's that type of lag introduced, when you're skilling people in different continents and the game's lagging, and there's a clear, obvious advantage. Like, it isn't running properly. So dedicated servers is the answer. Yeah. And with dedicated servers, there's, like, no DDoSing. Because if you try to DDoS on a dedicated server, you DDoS yourself. Like, it's so many layers to it, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Huge.
And maybe they'll get with Amazon. Or maybe since we're with Google now, right? Maybe there since we're with...
Yep.
Or maybe with Azure. And now Sony's in bed there, too, using those servers for... next generation, so
smart, man. They're teaming up against Stadia.
Exactly. Got to. It's like I use my Game of Thrones references. Stadia is like the White Walkers. You gotta unify. Dogs and cats sleep together. You gotta fight the walkers, man. They're coming.
Oh man. That's a whole lot of references in one sentence right there. I like that. yeah, so like that's kind of one of those for me that's always annoying because I literally live at like 1.43 KDA, and that's like just probably about a 1.0. And I'm just like, I have ups and downs. I feel like I do okay. I have some decent games, and I'm like, hey, and it's been, I think, most apparent as I've been working on Revoker because sniping is so you hit him or you don't. Like, the misses are very apparent. It's not like, hey, I missed a bullet on my go figure. I took a little longer to kill him. You miss or you don't. And I'll have games all going. It's like, I just got two crispy kills. I'm actually feeling good. Like, maybe this will be in a higher light reel in the next game. I just get stepped on and trashed, and like I can't shoot anybody. And those, so when like on PC, it's still there. Like, but I would say it seems better for sure. The loading times are like night and day. Just put you a fast hard drive in there, you'll feel it. Like, there are certain things about PC, like Destiny 2 is still going to have, but everything on PC is still going to be better in general for loading times, the field of view, frames per second, all those things are going to be worth the upgrade. And especially if you're going full time, like, you know, stick some of those YouTube checks away and be like, all right, I got a budget. Let me knock out this rig. Cool. Because if you already got two monitors, you're basically there anyway. You got that part out of the way. Then it's just a box that powers it all. So
only advice I would give you too, being that, you know, you play a lot of PvP, is that don't step in there until you have your loadout, until you have your weapons. Now, the adjustment. Yeah, the adjustment from, that's true too, cross save, you're right. But the adjustment from, I think the biggest adjustment I had to deal with was that you feel the level of accuracy when you're facing a mouse and keyboard guy, and you're going to know when not to challenge. Like, okay, you're about to engage, you're like, I'm late, or, you know, and you have to get out of it. You have to get your ego out of it, because the accuracy, you do feel it. But once you get your loadouts and smart play and, you know, your tactic, you're going to be more than fine. You're going to be more than fine. But when you play Switch, you'll feel it. You know what I'm saying? You'll definitely feel it. There's no doubt about it. But to me, it makes me better. I love it. I love the challenge. And I love when I see the few times that I'm at the top that I'm like, okay, I earned that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm doing my thing.
Yeah, I will say Fallout, when he looks for his research assistants when cross-save is there, he's going to have about 6,000 more tweet replies because everybody's going to be like, me, I'm here. Because I'd say, like right now, he'll be like, hey, who wants to get shot in the face right now? I'd be like, I would, I'm on the wrong console. He'd be like, right now, I'd be like, are you coming to PC or do I have to go over to PS4? What are we doing? Like, the cross-save is going to have so many cool moments for just stuff like that I can't wait for. And even if you're normally on Xbox, but you've got a rig that's decent, like you throw, honestly for you, like if you throw a graphics card in, if you got an i7, that's almost probably all you'd need if you just put RAM in there too. Like, you wouldn't need a lot to get started. And if you just spend some money on a graphics card now and be like, okay, I got a hella graphics card, it's even probably a little much. If you want to upgrade later, that'll last you a while. So there's different ways for you to go for upgrades that aren't like, let me build an entire thing from case, motherboard, bottom up. If you just throw a graphics card in, that might even work for you, a cool guy. This turned into apparently a tech talk. Sorry, everybody.
Yeah, he sent you a message.
What?
I think Cool Guy said he sent you a message in Discord.
Oh, hold on.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see Discord because it's full screened.
Yeah. Looking at it now.
Can I see BRB? Oh, yeah, he'll be right back. Okay, cool. That's fine.
Cool.
Yep, no biggie. Yeah, man. But yeah, it's like, honestly, it's been, like, the switch to PC for you has been fun to watch, because I know you gave me a hard time, you waited for a while, but now that you're here, you're like, all right, fine, still using my controller, though, so I'm holding true.
Yeah, man, I mean, it's been good. It's been good. I really, really enjoyed it. I'm fully, you know, indoctrinated. There's no going back, you know what I'm saying, right now. But I'll play a console more once the new next gen stuff comes out. But again, I'll be. But man, I love it. It's really cool, you know. And I'm just excited. I'm excited for that player base, man. I'm excited to see people come over. I'm excited more people playing with each other. You know, it's gonna do so much for the game in September. I cannot wait.
Yeah, there will be ups and downs to it, I think. Because for the ups, you'll have a population for things like Crucible and Gambit. You'll have a lot more people in there, and kind of leveling the playing field for kind of difficulty. Not everybody's going to be ultra sweaty, because that's all the people that are playing. But in turn, you're going to have people in strikes who don't know what the hell to do. You're going to have people in public events that don't know what a heroic is. Like, there's going to be a lot of learning for the new people. And people just boot it up, be like, oh, cool, what's this? Let me shoot this guy real quick. And, like, no clue what's going on. And there will be some veteran frustrations I can see on the PvE side of things. But then in PvP, people are like, man, my KD's going up and up. And I'm like, look at these games of, like, 40 kills. Me saying 40 kills is going to be a whole bunch of noobs on the other side. So stuff like that's going to happen. But
Love it, man. That's so much fun. I'm gonna be on, like, I don't know if you saw MTAS. He's got like a Erentil.
Yep, yeah, his fusion rifle that's busted.
Oh my god, it's hilarious. I'm gonna have a couple moments like that. If I get a few, it'll be good. Just to laugh. Like, okay, now I feel better about myself slaying blueberries.
That's probably about how, like, I mean, like, CoolGuy, who stepped away, but he'll be back. Like, CoolGuy, MTash, Fallout, when they're playing, they're just, like, they're just working people constantly. And, like, that'll be those, I don't get those feelings often when, like, the cards fall right, maybe. But, yeah, with a lot bigger player base, hopefully, and hopefully a few more rounds under my belt than they've got, it should feel pretty good. So.
Yeah, man. Absolutely. Cannot wait.
Yeah,
going to be some nice content in September.
I'm back. Sorry about that.
Oh, you're good. Yep. Yeah, we're just kind of rambling about, like, with new light players coming. I was saying, like, PvP populations are going to have some easy blueberries to shoot. And I was going to say, like, running strikes or public events is probably going to make you want to pull your hair out. So it's going to be both with the new population. But yeah, I know we've...
Inside the thing, don't kill the captain.
Oh.
Yeah.
So
we need to be heroic.
Yes.
Yeah. They're like, what's heroic? That's like, I feel like that's one of those videos I have to make. Like, heroic public events. Are you new? Make sure you, like, that's got to be one of the ones. It's like, learn what heroic public events are. Here's like, Nearest does awesome graphics for it. Like, all these things. There's a lot of resources. But look, if you're going to play this game, don't piss off the veterans. It's like, we'll help you, but you got to try a little bit.
So. I felt a lot of that when I first went over to PC. Like, I was like, a lot of these guys don't know how to do public events.
Well, like, you got on at the same time everything was free, right?
Yeah, I'm putting myself in that mentality come September, because literally that's what it was. I'm like, stop shooting. I'm using emotes like, no, stop shooting. Like, what are you doing? You know, so, oh, my God.
Yeah. That's
what, you got to laugh. These guys, first time.
Oh, yeah. That'll be brand new. So, well, CoolGuy, we will try and wrap this thing up. But before we go, one of the questions we do ask all of our guests, and since it sounds like you've been playing Destiny since forever, like us, I was Alpha. Were you Alpha, Cognito?
Yeah.
How about you, CoolGuy? Did you get in the Alpha?
Not. I was Beta.
Beta. Okay, fine. Beta, Alpha. Before it launched is kind of the point. We've been in this thing since it
started. As we're on PC, you're in the Alpha. Keep going. I know.
I know, right? He's like, shaming Destiny.
And cool guys over there, like, channel's bigger. I got a higher KD than you. It's fine. No, I'm just kidding.
I'm so glad that the exclusives were gone, man, because, like, as an Xbox player, dude, like, it went PC, PlayStation, Sega Dreamcast, SNES, Xbox. Like, it was, like, that's how you reviewed. So, I mean, we're all on the same page now. I'm excited.
No,
second-class citizen, Jade Rabbits and stuff.
Well, that was the thing, too. Like, as soon as PC launched for Destiny 2, I went to it. And that's when I was like, well, I guess I won't be talking about PlayStation 4 exclusives for a while. Because I literally had been on PlayStation. That's where I'd been. And then I jumped to PC and I was like, oh, yeah, that's a thing. I didn't think about it until a little while. And
bro,
I was like,
Xbox guys were suffering, bro.
Oh, I know.
It was tough out here. Cool guy, no. It was tough. I'll never forget. Real quick tangent. Taken King, they had, was it Jade Rabbit, Zen Meteor. Yep, and there were a couple of maps and a couple of suits. And I'm like, all right. As an Xbox guy, you got used to it. You're like, okay, we're going to get that, you know, the next DLC, you know, whatever, or next year, like a year. But you're like, okay, I'll deal with it. And I believe it was Rise of Iron. So I'm sitting there like, yeah, I'm ready for my Jade Rabbit. And then I'll never forget, like, Deej got on stream and these guys got on stream and they were like, yeah, based on the partnership, you know, it's not happening, you know, and it got extended like another year. They didn't, Xbox guys did not get those guns until D2 came out. And I'm like, are you kidding me right now? Like, this is, oh, that was painful, bro. And then we got Hawk Moon late. Like,
the worst one was the Hawk Moon, man. Completely.
Yeah,
Hawk Moon.
Yeah, good, man. You know exactly the feel. We never experienced it in its hay. Like the magic bullet, man. It hurt. It was tough to be an Xbox guy for Destiny, but you just stuck with it, man.
And then content creation. Like, Destiny comes out, you know, and then my new videos. All right, guys, we're checking out the Jade Rabbit today.
They're like, wasn't that like 2 years ago? And you're like, yep, that's just brand new for me, so we're covering it.
It's brand new.
Mm-hmm.
Brand new for me. But the question is, with the long history that you've got, see if you can come up with your top three, just for you, top three moments in your experience of all of Destiny.
Moments would be the beta.
Mm.
There was the queue of 60,000 people.
You know, Oh, yeah.
Indeed.
With this, you know, when they open up the moon, right?
That was so
to this day, that's why I'm so excited they're bringing back the moon, man, because like, if you go back in D1 and just look at the sky, you see the satellites and the shooting, like, it's just so cool. And then like, and like, as Luke Smith was saying right now, like, I'll never forget that.
Nice.
Would be, on a personal note, running YouTube with Destiny. Just kind of seeing what I wanted to talk about. And there was so much, there's way more depth in the weapons in Destiny 1, which is a shame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sad but true.
Yeah, because there was so much you could do with the weapons in D1. Mm-hmm. And the third one would probably be my first raid clear, and that was Vault of Glass.
Salute.
It's not
always
the best.
Been a console player. I've never done anything like that.
Mm.
Six people doing an activity like that. Facts. Like, I'll never forget it, right?
Bro, I got to cut you 1 second because you bring in feels. Cool guy, you bring in feels. I think you nailed it because that was literally the moment that hooked me into the game. I played the campaign. I was done with it. I wasn't that impressed with Destiny. And I'll never forget. People were like, no, get to level 30. And I grinded out. And Fall to Glass was that moment. And at that point, I've never done a six-man activity that was coordinated. It just had all these things involved. It blew my mind. I was like, this is next level. I've never experienced this, but continue with your, that was a great moment.
Totally correct, man. Like, as I remember, like, it was so fun and rewarding, right?
Yeah.
I mean, granted, you know, you're forever 29, you know, because you didn't get the boots or whatever.
Mine was the helm. Like, mine was the helm forever.
Mm-hmm.
With that raid, I mean, there was Fatebringer. Ooh. There was all these different weapons that were tied to it. And then, of course, the Vex.
Vision.
There's no room in the Crucible for 52 headshot Vex. Just saying. Right?
Wow.
Bring it back.
OG form.
But just doing that, especially as someone like me, because like I play a lot of Crucible, and when I play Crucible, I play alone a lot because for the gameplay, I try to get like raw versus. I mean, when I play with people or someone messages me, I'll talk with them if I'm not doing anything, and I'll play with them, right? So like a subscriber, mm-hmm. like a fan. Yeah. I very rarely six stack, but like players that I play with, I've been playing with for about 8 to 10 years. There's about 7 of us, 8 of us. We all know mm-hmm. each other very, very well. Been to all of our weddings, right?
Nice.
So that was the first time we ever did something like that together. And like that's what got us as a group hooked on Destiny.
Nice. Facts. That community, man. That's what it did. That. Yeah.
Well, those are honestly, yeah, those are all three. So you got, the beta, the raid, and then YouTube, and those are legit. I know we've had ours before as well. But it's like the experience, as you say, it's like this game does things that pretty much nothing else does. And that's one, like everybody who talks about those, whether it's like we had Mark at GuardianCon talking about just like first experiences and just like him mm-hmm. in the podcast and stuff like that for you and your YouTube channel, for us in the podcast. And a lot of what we get to see is the community building something more than they ever expected it would be.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And a final point on what you said, E2, is another nice touch was loading Destiny 2 and seeing those kind of flashback remembrance kind of sequences of who was in your fire team when you completed stuff. And, there's a couple people, unfortunately, that, are no longer on this earth. They passed away. But it really hit me because I'm like, wow, I remember that. I remember when we did that raid. Remember this person. Wow. And you forged those lifelong friendships. Obviously me and you with the last word, basically because of GuardianCon, I know people. I remember when I did Oryx hard and shout out to Frodo. He's in my clan. Like I've known him 4 or 5 years. Like I told him, I'm like, dude, we went through Vietnam together. Like Oryx hard mode was like, that was it for me. Like I was such a struggle to get that raid clear done for my first time. And like he was on that team. You remember, you formed that bond, that trust with that person. And it's just the memories. Again, there's a lot of good games, but in my opinion, like that's what Destiny does better than any other game. It's just that community, bringing people together and those memorable.
Yeah. So I don't know if we can top it better than that for an ending. So cool guy. It has been awesome to have you on. You obviously, of course, are always welcome anytime you want to chat. We love talking about Destiny and being nerdy, of course. So yeah, no, it was our pleasure. Absolutely. So for those who are listening, if you just want to tell them where to find you, what you got working on, anything you got coming in the future, where to find you at GuardianCon, apparently besides the, keep an eye out for you. At least I won't reveal any secrets or anything. So.
Yeah. So my YouTube channel is youtube.com/CoolGuyTips. Mm-hmm. And on Twitter, I am CoolGuyYT. I try to post as much as I can. Now, I do have a Twitch channel. It's I_am_CoolGuy. The way I do YouTube, like I don't have time for it. And I want to be able to a point where I can stream more because I love streaming, dude. I love talking with people while I'm playing. Nice. But that's my main thing. And of course, at GuardianCon, if you find me, I have stickers and magnets for you. So
holler.
Nice. Very nice. Awesome stuff. So yeah, find this man. He puts out amazing content. He will show you things that you never thought you should be using. He's going to show you that they're better than probably what you think is good. So he's going to give you some good things to look at. Excellent content. Cognito, of course, as well for you. Always putting in lots of work in many facets. What do you got coming up, sir?
Yeah, man. You already know a lot of stuff up on lordsofgaming.net right now. So like I said, check it out. I've got a little article on the Destiny cross-save situation and just, some roadmap for the future and my thoughts on that. Obviously, the YouTube channel, I Lord Podcast. Please, every Sunday is the Lord's Day, 1 p.m. Eastern. This week, we will be taking a break. As you know, I'm going to be traveling, And then I believe Soph has some travel stuff. So we're going to take a break this Sunday, but we will return, next Sunday, hopefully. And, we're going to have some big guests, some industry people, of course. I'm working on some game developers and also some other executives. So look out for that. We've got some fun stuff planned. And on the channel, you know, King of Statues, Lord King, he's, if you're a statue guy, you love that kind of stuff, please check it out. And then, of course, the last word, my man Ebontis, talking that looter shooter talk like we do. And a ton of it being, 90% of it being Destiny.
Yeah, we were like, oh, looter shooters. We had Anthem coming, and then and then Division was going to come. And
yeah,
we're basically just talking about Destiny again. So that was short-lived.
It's the Phoenix, man. The thing rises every single time. Like, it looks bleak, and then, you know, Anthem doesn't survive. All the quote-unquote Destiny killers don't end up surviving. No. And here comes Destiny right back. Nope. So, yeah.
And it only looks like it's getting, only looks like it's truly going in an amazing direction, I think. So
absolutely.
And then for me, you guys all know where to find me. It's Ebontis everywhere. Ebontis. If you find the cheetah, you found me. We will be at GuardianCon. And I'm looking forward to it. There's so many people. It's like, I want to shake your hand. It's like looking forward to meeting like a lot of people that I've actually, like, in the past kind of year or so, since things have kind of started to blow up and stuff like that, to be just a little bit more like, hi, like, hello, I'm this guy. Just like, and shake so many people's hands. Like, to do like Destiny Community Podcast. Like, you've been on there, right? Too cool guy, I'm pretty sure. Cause I feel like you have the.
Yes, I've spoken with him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. But I was like, I usually can tell because, like, you look at people's Twitter profiles and their, like, face pic is the one that Ash did for you.
Oh, my, dude. I have that framed on my wall.
It's so good.
Phenomenal artist, dude.
I was so proud of E when he was on. He made it.
No, but it's like, because it was so funny. I talked to her about the art that she does. I was like, you do such an amazing job every time. And then it was just a Twitter DM, and I sent it to her, and she replied back and was just like, hey, the content you do is great too. Thanks for helping out the solo players. And I was like, I'm sorry, excuse me, what? Like, I'm still at the point of like, I don't know. I don't think people know me, because I don't think they do. So it's one of those that's, it's really cool to kind of go out there and hopefully just like meet a lot of people. But honestly, like, there's so many Bungie devs that are going, I feel like I'm just going to like park a chair at their table and just like, I want to talk to them all for like a day. So. No, GuardianCon is going to be a whole lot of fun this year, and I think I'll be broke from buying art from some of these artists out there.
Oh, yes. Bro. You should have never showed me that artist. That
so,
had that
like, Brian Monkus, his has been crazy. There's so many out there. I can't even list them all. There's one I'd have to look through and scroll through. They've done, like, it's a graphic of, like, kind of shorter character type three guardians in the background is kind of the theme. One of them was Last Wish with like ribbon behind, and then but it's like the list of Destiny artists just goes and goes. Like Belle, what is it, Maribel? I can't even think of her name too. She's got some really cool ones. Belle Mare by Maul, but she's got some awesome. There's so many. Like Will and won't be there, but it's like between buying people drinks, buying art there, and just saying hello, like, I'm going to be broke and exhausted, and it's going to be awesome.
It's going to be awesome, bro. We back together again.
I know, dude. I haven't seen you in literally that since 4 years ago now. It's insane.
About 4 years, yeah. That's where it all started, man. Get to meet Cool Guy in the building.
Got to actually
hang out. We can grab some beers, man, if you guys want, man.
Oh, absolutely, man. I'm looking forward to Kakis. Always like chopping up with him. Fallout. Plays no DCP this year. That's gonna feel weird, though.
Dude.
I know. It's gonna feel weird. No, I love those guys, man. Especially Holtz. Like, I'm a big Holtz fanboy. So he's actually doing something with Bungie, right? Is he?
I think he's contract tester. He's back up there again. Yeah, like that. He's doing that. It's an amazing community, and we probably can't say it enough. And like, anytime you reach out and be like, hey, do you want to come on the podcast? Cool. It's like, it's 2 hours. You're like, dude, I can talk about Destiny for a while. Like, nobody seems to usually mind. They may not know like how long it's going to go, and you may be like, okay, I'm done. I'm tired of talking to you guys. It's cool. But like 2.5 hours later, it's like, we can always go. So it's been an absolute pleasure. So thank you very much. We try and time this thing, but with delays and everything, it's always terrible. But I always try and say, and this has been, and we just finished with the last word. So there's usually a delay, so I'll try and match you guys. But when I say it has been, and then you guys try and say it together for the last word, and I'll try and match you. So, all right, guys, for episode 64, it has been amazing to have Cool Guy on here. Lord Cognito, of course, of the Iron Lords podcast. And for this episode, it has been the last word.